Okay, thank you all. This is the July 20th. It's a special council meeting. We have already called the meeting to order and called the roll. And thank you for being patient as our initial executive session ran a little late. The first item on the agenda is our announcements. First, we'll let these guys go first so they can leave if they would like. We have Fire Chief Colin Altman here and Emily Seibel from Home Inc. To talk about a project that they want the community to know about.
Thank you very much.
So whoever.
Can you hear me?
It's okay for people to be in the volume. We're all right with that.
I know. So can you get around there?
You can take the microphone. You can actually take the microphone out.
Donahue, take the microphone. We've got total high tech.
And then this.
Well.
No one can hear us. How's that?
I'm Colin. This is Emily.
Hello.
You all know us, I hope. So we're here today, like a year and a half ago? Mm-hmm. I came here and asked for the council's support.
I'm going to stop you for a minute. Can you talk so that the camera can pick you up as well? Yeah.
Oh, I see myself. So we came and asked for council support for our fire station project to build at 1001 Xenia Avenue, the former WSU clinic site, and you graciously gave that. So in the interest of time, we're back today with Emily and Home Inc., who have partnered with us on our project. When I was here before, we spoke about there was a possibility we could have another partner with us, either senior housing or a doctor's office. Our project dragged on too long for the physician's office. So now we have this wonderful collaboration with Emily and Home Inc., not just Emily.
Sure. So together we're able to bring more resources to the proposal, working together, and to meet a number of identified public goals for the village and the township. And Wright State is interested in working with us. We are confident that we can gain site control given the partnership, as well as some administrative changes at Wright State. We're developing a more streamlined approach to real estate. How streamlined, time will tell. But Wright State indicated in a recent email that they are enthusiastic about this idea, about the partnership, about the possibility of working with us. And they really see that new affordable housing, township offices, and a new fire station are value added to the community. And they further supported community goals of enhanced fire and EMS services alongside the availability of new, affordable, and accessible housing for elders. And they ended the email saying, we hope to establish a contract in the near future. Colin, would you like to say anything?
Anyway, so we're here. Wright State is very eager to have some kind of demonstration of the local government's support of the project. So what we're here to ask for is a letter of conceptual support.
Preliminary conceptual support.
For this project, which is indicated on the piece of paper you guys have and on this beautiful blow-up of the project. This is extremely preliminary. Our architects put it together basically just to show that both projects, senior housing and a township administration building and fire station, could fit together on the lot, which is just under 4 acres. There's a lot that could be changed, obviously, and zoning and all that kind of stuff, but first we need to get our hands on the property. And Wright State was very eager to see some type of letter of support. I spoke with Patty, and she felt it was best to come to council directly since this body did that in the past for us. So
council, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say that this is not our asking for any kind of binding approval for the project. It's just to get us to step one, as Colin said. So I just want to be really clear that what we're hoping for is the chance to go through the public process.
With this mock-up, how many units does that estimate?
That is showing, I believe, 38 units. It says on the...
Oh, does it? Oh, it does. 38 units, yes. And then four cottages.
And so I did provide a draft letter that was taken from the last letter that I wrote that council approved of, changed, obviously, for this particular project. I actually have a hard copy here signed if council approves with that letter as written that I can give to these two. If we want to make changes, then we can make those changes and get them a letter at a later time, or if we don't want to provide a letter, then we'll decide that too.
I think it's a great letter, but can you tell us a bit about what this will afford you in terms of the fire station
Certainly.
That you don't have now?
Well, the biggest thing it'll give us is a safe facility. Any of you who've been to our fire station have probably tripped or been hit by the stuff falling off the ceiling or anything like that. So that's part of our problem. It's too small for the apparatus we have. It doesn't have any overnight sleeping arrangements. And as we have grown over the years, we have crews in station overnight now, and they have to fight for beds. And it's just too small. We're about 6,700 square feet right now. This will take us to about 15,000 square feet, give us enough room for new trucks, new ambulances. We've got to buy a new tanker truck, but we can't do it right now because it won't fit in our current firehouse. So short of a tent, we figure we'll just hold off. And so that's kind of the driving push for this on our part.
And then the property that you currently own down the bike path there, would you guys be selling that? I assume you own that building?
Yes, we own the building and the property. The Board of Trustees hasn't made a final decision, obviously, mm-hmm. on that yet, but they have discussed putting it on the market and selling it.
Okay. Any other questions for either Emily or Colin? So is council in agreement with me handing this letter as it's written to one of the two of them?
Yeah.
Yes, I also think it's a great letter.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, thanks for doing that.
I like the literal and figurative
yes.
reference.
Good luck.
Very clever.
Thank you very much. We'll keep you guys posted. Obviously, as this progresses, first we just have to get our hands on the property. So short of declaring martial law, we'll be trying to purchase it, but if that doesn't work, martial law may be the way to go. No, I'm kidding.
And you notice the last... yeah, and the last line leaves it open to them gifting. You know, I said a price that makes sense or a deal that makes sense for a small community. So hopefully they'll be generous.
Let's all keep our collective fingers crossed.
Thank you.
Thank you guys very much.
Oh, shoot. Okay, any other announcements from council members?
I have two. First of all, I just wanted to... We had a notice from Patty today about the peak shaving that happened from 2 to 6 p.m. We have another one tomorrow. Patty, do you just want to remind people what that means?
Part of our new agreement with Dayton Power and Light offers us the opportunity to shave our power during the heaviest use periods, and it's called peak shaving. And what peak shaving enables us to do is our peak shaving rates for next year are set upon the peaks that the amount we use during peak events this year. So what we want to do is limit our use of electricity during those hours, and it helps us to decrease our costs next year.
And tomorrow it's also from 2 to 6 p.m.
That's correct.
The other thing I wanted to mention is if you did not go out and see the Yellow Springs Kids Playhouse show this past weekend, you've got four more days. And this one's special because it's the farm, and it's about how our community came together to save Whitehall Farm and continue to have that sort of a green belt around our community. Starts at 7:30. It's out at the amphitheater, and I heard the weather's supposed to be nice this weekend.
Yeah, it was an adventure last night, wasn't it?
Yes. Yeah, it was fun. And I had a lot of kids with me, too, so they got pretty crazy. But anyway, we enjoyed it.
Anything else? Okay. Excuse me. Oh, Sam.
Address council? Unrelated subject, but it won't take a moment.
Sure.
I'm here as a representative of Glen Helen Association. Several months ago, we came and asked for a resolution of support for a grant application, the purpose of which was to acquire the Case property and make it part of Glen Helen. Just a status report, I'm telling you that the grant was awarded about a week ago.
Great.
And so that project moves forward. I'll give you another status report when it closes or any other thing intervenes. But for the moment, everything looks positive, and the grant has been awarded.
Excellent.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Sam. Good job, guys.
I would have come 2 weeks from now, but I'm going to be out of town. I know this is a work session.
Oh, no, actually, this is a meeting. This is a regular meeting, so.
The work session is at 7:00.
Review of the agenda, it's pretty self-explanatory. We're just basically doing legislation. And then we'll just review the future agenda items, too. Lori, do you want to review the petitions and communications?
Well, all of them are either related to agenda items, with the exception of Melissa Van Zandt's June financials. And because it was such a big report, I didn't sort of summarize it, but I guess I was hoping she would be here and I would just call on her to talk about it.
She was on vacation.
Oh, good for her. So. But well-deserved, because mm-hmm. it was a positive report. We have achieved a clean audit, yes. which she's been working very hard on the last few years. There's been things she's really had to work hard to get us to that point. And most of the funds are looking better than expected. Is that a fair
That's
summary?
That's a very fair summary.
I don't know if you
yes,
that
the, yeah, but to me the two big things out of that, number one, our revenue was a little bit ahead of what we had anticipated, and number two, our expenses are coming in
right.
lower than we had anticipated. So
and I know and what you want.
And to me, you know, we have to give thanks to our department heads and to our mm-hmm. employees. That they're being frugal in
very much
their requests and so forth, but still getting the job done to, I feel, the community satisfaction.
And I would just like to say that the clean audit is just an amazing feat for Melissa to be able to have gotten this year in her second full year here, because it took me 2 full years to get one when I was at the jail. And once you get a clean audit, it's really easy to keep it clean because you've got your practices down. So it takes a lot of effort, and Melissa did an incredible job.
And
excellent.
Her presentations of financials have just gotten clearer and clearer and made me feel a lot more confident about where we are financially. And we are not in a state of diving into pools full of money and throwing them up in the air by any means, but things were looking pretty dire a couple of last year, I think, especially the year before, and I feel much steadier about them, but it's still tricky. There's right. not a lot of room in the budget for capital projects, for things that we kind of need to do. And that's the struggle we're still going to be facing.
I think what I would say after talking to Melissa last week is that we're looking much better for 2015 than she expected, mm-hmm. but we're still not looking. We're still into the future. We're back yes. going to be back in the same position, but right. at least not as quickly.
Right.
So we do need an approval on that. I wasn't sure if that was going to be part of the. Consent agenda for the next meeting, or
the next, and then you'll have the July
okay.
financials. She was hoping for it.
Okay, so can I get a motion for approval of the June financials?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And one other thing, I will kind of jump ahead a little bit based upon the letter from Niraj.
Yes.
And Tani, he actually responded to the letter. He's a state representative and not even from our district, from, I think, south in the Miami Township area, Montgomery County,
Miami
Township.
Yeah.
Actually did respond to a letter that we sent to the governor and to some state senators, because they were, again, messing around with municipal budgets and municipal funding. So. It was basically a general letter saying, you're not helping us, and please stop messing with our money. And he actually responded and said that he has been opposing all of those measures all along, and that he's actually is going to put a proposal forth that they start to refund the local government fund. So that's nice to know. And that ties into a future agenda item. August 24th, mm-hmm. We're talking about having a special meeting. We've been contacted by Rick Perales, who is actually our state representative, to come to that meeting and do a little kind of review of what he's doing. Rick has continuously told me, we aren't doing anything to your funds. So I decided, especially since the discussion is finance, that would be a great meeting for Rick to come to, and we can ask, you know, kind of tell him how we feel and see what he has to say. So that wasn't on the agenda. I just wanted to make sure you all were in agreement with that.
That's okay. A great idea.
And Melissa will have an analysis of how their actions did affect our budget.
Excellent.
And by the way, it was Representative Antani that hosted the International Fellows when we went up to visit the State House. So
great.
Yeah, he's very responsive.
Anything else for announcement? Or I guess we're done with announcements. So we're moving on to legislation. First, we have Resolution 2015-20. And I feel like we can read these all by title only.
Okay, as soon as I get there, you zipped along. Yes, this is authorizing the village manager to submit an application to the Ohio Public Works Commission for the water plant project.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Patty, I will let you explain this.
This is simply the necessary legislation for me to submit the application for the $1.3 million 0% interest loan, as well as the credit enhancement program for the Ohio Public Works Commission. The application was actually due last Friday. I turned in the application, but you can turn in the authorizing legislation later. So. The credit enhancement, in case someone doesn't understand what that is, OPWC has a program where if part of your project is a loan from another agency, such as the Ohio Water Development Authority, OPWC, if you're awarded the grant, will pay the interest on your loan for the construction period. For us, if we're awarded that, it would come to about $162,000 for the 16-month construction period.
Nice.
So we're applying for a $1.3 million loan at 0% interest for 30 years, as well as credit enhancement program on the OWDA loan for the remainder, $3.7 million, and that would equal about $162,000.
And is this resolution for the credit enhancement, or is it for everything?
It's for everything.
Okay.
You have to have legislation for both of them, because they're separate applications. So they can be in the same piece of legislation, but it has to name both programs.
We should make it clear that Patty really looked hard into grant money, which is obviously nice because you don't have to pay back grant money, but it's a complicated process getting grants. It can be very difficult depending on your situation. And so she looked, ran the numbers, talked to lots of grant specialists, people who do this all the time, who looked at our situation, and their advice was that our best opportunity was to go for this 0% financing loan rather than any grants that we could try to apply for, but which if we didn't get, then would
not get the loan money.
Then we wouldn't get the loan money. So it's a difficult call, but I was convinced she's written some things about it in the packet very briefly, but that was my understanding of what she wrote to us and has explained to us. So I am for this.
Any other?
Patty, just a quick question. The $5 million estimate, mm-hmm. does that include or exclude the consultant fees?
Includes.
Okay.
And where it says that second whereas, it talks about round 30, the grant cycle.
It's all the same cycle.
Okay.
Yeah, it's all the same cycle. The grants and the loans, they have to actually give the loan money away before they're allowed to award grants.
Yes,
So. Okay, are we ready to take a vote?
Yes.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay, we've got Resolution 2015-24.
Yeah, this is adjusting village employee wage scales.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. when the employee wages were, when the employees got a cost of living increase back in January, it was a determination of the village manager that, based upon comparisons of what other communities were doing, that 2% was about where we should be, and given what past wage increases had been. Given the dire situation we were looking at in January, as far as the budget was concerned, we asked the employees to take just a 1% increase, and then said that mid-year we would come back and reevaluate. And I think, given the conversation that we just had about how the budget is looking for 2015, and also the fact that expenses are down thanks to the hard work of our staff, that I at least feel comfortable and feel that this is something that would be good for staff to get this 1% now as of July 1st. It would be retroactive to July 1st. Anything you wanted to add?
No, that's a good recap.
Just that we did budget for this, so
right.
We sort of planned that we would try to do this, but we wanted to make sure we felt okay about the budget, mm-hmm. before we released the whole raise of 2% total.
Any other comments or questions? Comments or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next is 2015-25.
Approving a contract with Susan Gartner to serve as Channel 5 station manager.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. I'm going to turn this over to Brian. It looks like there's a different document, a different contract that we're looking at. So
yeah, it just has two small but I think better changes. One is a notice of 15 days instead of 60 days. It didn't really make sense when we discussed that. Given that that's the standard for other contracts. And secondly, and Patty and I talked with Susan about this, it is an annual review just to see where things were at, a sort of check-in. So that's all that's changed with the document. I mean, I would just like to highlight a few reasons why I think this is important. Maybe the most important thing is that our first village value, I'll just read it, is to deepen decision-making processes with active citizen participation and effective representative governance. And you know, I think that sort of underlies why community access is so important. It helps make sure that citizens who can't attend the meetings can see what we're doing and be active participants. We've talked about before that we do get a franchise fee from Time Warner, which annually is about $40,000. So we certainly have the funds to do this. And you know, Karen's emphasized many times that you know, we have this council and all councils have had a commitment to transparency. And again, this is where the station feeds in. And I think everybody's been really impressed with Susan's work. So thanks a lot. And I want to give a shout out to Channel 5. If you haven't checked it out recently, Susan's been putting lots of cool photos from different events like July 4th, all kinds of Bulldog news, and of course, all of our government meetings.
Brian, could you briefly review the terms, just what she will be doing and the hours she'll be working?
Right. So it's so we're paying $15 an hour. Susan's working as a contract employee, so there are no benefits or anything else. It's 20 hours a week. And one of the things that have been really impressive, if you followed the station manager's reports, is Susan's ability to make that 20 hours work so that we sort of have the priorities that we need, which again is filming the government meetings, making sure that they're not only on Channel 5, but also on the web, which has become a great way for most people in town to watch. And otherwise, if there's any extra time, then it's doing fun stuff like Bulldog News and pictures. So
I want to stop and say thank you to Paul Abendroth for his years of doing this for free.
Yes.
Yeah. And Paul hasn't left yet. Paul's been helping us. Yeah, in fact, he helped us hook up the rooms A and B, so we can broadcast that live tonight as well.
Great. Good. Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Any other comments or questions from council, citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next is resolution 2015-26.
Yes, this is authorizing the village manager to submit a non-binding letter of interest to American Municipal Power Incorporated regarding the possible realignment of the village's power supply portfolio.
Okay, I will ask the, can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I will ask the village manager to explain this.
Periodically, we're given the opportunity to realign our energy portfolio through AMP. One of the things that council has consistently talked about since I've been here is getting rid of our Omega JV2, the gas-fired plant, and potentially picking up other green forms of energy. We have that opportunity to divest ourselves of the Omega, the Fremont Energy Center, and the Omega JV2, which is likely to shut down in a couple of years anyway, and potentially pick up some part of the Napoleon Solar Facility, as well as maybe some of the wind energy.
The diesels are likely to shut down
in the next couple of years. However, they are being retrofitted right now, so that's not a done deal. What this will do is, even if we divest ourselves of Fremont and we don't pick up anything else, mm-hmm. and it leaves a little bit of room in our portfolio, we can potentially buy that off the grid, which in the meantime, while it wouldn't necessarily be green energy, it will not increase our cost, because buying off the grid right now is about the same as what we're paying for Fremont. And it does give us the opportunity to use that room in the portfolio over the next couple of years to look at our own solar field, like we were talking about, which is something that we should have more information on by the end of the month. Through Saulville and Associates, John Courtney has been working with Saulville and Associates through the Western Area Service Group to put out an RFP for community-owned solar arrays. And we did submit a site for that. We haven't heard anything back. So hopefully we'll hear something back from that. They did, while I was on vacation, John did go on a site visit with them, with Johnny Burns, and they seemed happy with our site. So we will wait and see what happens. But in the meantime, we do have to submit a non-binding letter of interest if council wants to divest of Fremont and to potentially pick up some of the solar and or wind. And that is what John Courtney and myself, as well as the Energy Board, recommends doing.
Will it have any impact to our cost of power?
It will not have any impact to our cost of power, because right now what you buy off the grid is essentially what we're paying for Fremont.
But are we buying into more expensive?
No.
Okay.
No. Well, you're asking, is this, the only difference is that solar, it takes more solar to make up what you're buying from, to make up okay. an equal amount of natural gas.
And I don't know, maybe the other answer would be that we won't know until the negotiations happen. If you look at the timeline,
that's correct.
It's, you know, a year and a half out.
Right.
2 years, in fact. So that gives us time to, you know, start to plan and think about community solar.
Right.
I also wanted to just manage a couple other expectations. It seems that JV2 probably wouldn't be very attractive on the market,
right.
according to John Courtney.
Because it's probably going to shut down.
Right. Mm-hmm. It may be hard to buy into wind because it's small, but
right.
you know, it's still worth trying. And Fremont, John Courtney thinks is very attractive, and we could probably offload the whole thing.
Right. He said that he is, as soon as we began talking about potentially divesting of the Fremont natural gas, that he had people asking to buy it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not going to be difficult to get rid of Fremont. It's going to be a little bit more difficult to get the solar in its place, and mm-hmm. harder than that to get the wind.
Mm-hmm.
But it's non-binding, and we don't have to commit. So,
but part of the reason we bought into Fremont in the first place is because it is a brand new, cleaner natural gas facility.
Mm-hmm.
And likely, if we're buying all that power off the grid, we're going to be buying coal. So it's there was a reason. I mean, we just didn't buy Fremont because
it
was, you know, we knew we were buying, not buying renewable, a renewable resource, but it seemed the better of the options.
I just feel like our portfolio is pretty tightly packed, and I think it would be good to have a little looseness. Yes, it means we're buying from the market, but it, I think there's enough interest in this village to both the solar power, not just us buying solar, but people installing solar, companies installing solar, that I don't want us to be as tightly, to have too little wiggle room for mm-hmm. for those options. So that's my thinking, and I think that is, I sense that that's where the village is, that because of the concerns about fracking, that having the village invested in natural gas, which is definitely cleaner than coal in many ways, the fracking process is concerning.
And the other thing I'm wondering is about divesting of a little bit of the hydro. I know that that might be surprising since it's green energy, but I think we're over-invested in hydro.
And it's expensive.
We talked about that. And the problem is because the plants are so far over budget that John felt it would be difficult to get anybody to take them at 100%. Now, you may be able to put them on there and somebody buy them at 70%, but that still leaves us on the hook for the other 30%, and we're not getting any energy out of it.
Now, I mean, one thing is we can, you know, include any of these in the letter of interest, whether they're attractive or not. Right. So, and then, but again, I guess that wasn't emphasized because of what Patty said. It didn't seem like we would get much bang for our buck.
Right. Because if you're able to get somebody to take it at 100%, then you're no longer bound for the remainder of the cost. But if they take it at like 70%, they are only taking 70% of the cost and not.
But you're saying we're not retaining 30% of that.
You're not retaining 30% of the power. The only thing you're retaining is 30% of the cost.
Well, they're getting the power. That doesn't make any sense. That,
right.
I mean, that's,
they're just
so
saying,
we
we'll take it off your hands, but not for the full cost.
Well, that doesn't make a lot of sense.
But we, again, you know, we don't know anything until the negotiations happen.
Right. And it is an extended time period. It's a year and a half to 2 years down the road before you actually sell this or buy something.
And there's time for more public discourse about this because this is just a non-binding letter.
Correct.
It'll come again before council,
right,
and we will have a vote.
Yes. Yeah. The non-binding letter of interest has to be in by the 23rd, so it has to be in by the end of the week, which is why it has to be dealt with tonight. Yeah. But it is non-binding, and before there is final action taken, it will come before council again.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Well, I appreciate what you're saying, Karen, first of all, about why we got into Fremont, and we're having to make a choice between long-term and short-term.
Mm-hmm.
Short-term, we might be using coal, for the long-term, being able to get into solar or wind. But it seems like a reasonable thing to me, for the reasons that Lori was saying.
And you do have a letter in your packets from the Energy Board
supporting
that.
So. Right. Any comments or questions from citizens? Eric?
I'm Eric Johnson. I'm on the Energy Board. I just wanted to thank Pat for coming to the meeting for several months and working so hard on this project, keeping your ear to the ground to know that this is possible. I also want to say 580 kilowatts is
for
what we're talking about.
For Fremont?
For Fremont?
675.
No, that's
580 is what we have.
480. It's 4.
What,
well, anyway, yes, 580.
It's less than the Antioch solar field.
Correct.
Yeah.
So we're not talking about a huge amount of dangerous energy that we might have to buy.
Correct.
And we could easily replace it with 1.5 megawatts of solar locally or at Napoleon or someplace else. But thank you, Patty and John, for all the work that you've done to make this come about.
Thanks, Eric. Let's take a vote. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Finally, we have resolution 2015-27.
Sorry, this is authorizing the village manager to enter into a contract with Rumpke Incorporated for solid waste management.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty, yours.
Okay, you know, as you know, we put out an RFP for solid waste. We got one bid back. You should have in your packets a comparison sheet like this, which shows you the Rumpke base bid, the Rumpke alternate bid, as well as our current cost. The difference between the base bid and the alternate bid, the base bid was exactly as it is now, where Rumpke provides a recycling waste wheeler for every resident. The and all, we also still have the tiered rate program. The alternate bid was where Rumpke provides a recycling waste wheeler as well as a regular garbage waste wheeler for every household, and potentially a second recycling waste wheeler, because we do have people who fill their recycling up every week and don't have any room for anything. The difference between the two, the reason that I did that was, number one, to encourage more recycling, and number two, because if usually if the company provides all of the waste wheelers, they can do an entirely automated pickup with the trucks, and it saves you a little money. It did not work out that way in our bid. It's a very minimal difference. Based on the comparison, say for a tier one over the course of 5 years, you're only saving $2.64 using the alternate bid as opposed to the base bid. The base bid is guaranteed for 2 years with 3 one-year extensions. The alternate bid was a 3-year contract with 2 one-year extensions. So that's why the prices are locked in for 3 years, and they don't go up until the fourth on the alternate bid. But to me, it's not really worth the disruption. A lot of folks want to use their own garbage cans. So I recommend to council that we accept the Rumpke-based bid and negotiate some of the other things. There are slight increases in the cost over what we're paying now, but it's nothing exorbitant. It's reasonable.
Mm-hmm. Looks like there's the 40-yard metal, though.
That's one thing that we're going to have to talk to them about before we sign the contract. There are a couple of questions that Jason and I both have. Remember, this is just their proposal. This is not the contract. So while I expect the base bid tiers to stay the same, some of these other things can be negotiated a little bit once we accept.
Okay. Any other comments or questions, Council?
Not me, no.
Any idea why we only had one bid?
I do not know. We had 4 packets picked up, actually, and I'm not sure why we only got one back. I mean, it wasn't all that unusual of a bid package.
Did you comments from call? Citizens? No.
Okay.
Oh, Rose.
Hi, I'm Rose Pelzel. I remember a conversation you had maybe a couple months ago about the frequency of Rumpke coming and picking up the trash.
Right, the number of truck trips.
Because of the use of gas in this, is that at all negotiable in this new contract?
Well, we looked at it, and because they would have to send multiple trucks to the village on one day, as opposed to sending one of each kind of truck 4 days a week, it didn't really decrease the number of truck trips. We kind of looked at that early on and did the math, and it just didn't really change anything.
Okay.
And we also included Tom Clevenger, right?
Yeah,
right.
Tom Clevenger, and Tom Dietrich, and Dana Stortz were also very helpful in negotiating this.
Okay.
So we did have corroboration that, it didn't save
that's too
the
bad.
Environment.
I was like, that seems like such an easy thing to, just cut out a truck trip. But
yeah, there is the if they have a certain kind of truck. Right.
They Rumpke does. They are going partially to a natural gas fired truck, actually, and they're investing in that quite a bit of money in doing that. So they are going to cleaner energy, and that is noted in their bid. Which they only brought me one copy of their bid, but it is noted in their bid. So
So at this point, citizens will not notice any change in their trash collection whatsoever.
That's correct.
Although the rates will be going up slightly. Any other questions or comments? We're ready to take a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
So just to review again, future agenda items, we will not have a meeting on August 3rd. On August 17th, we will have an executive session, or a work session, excuse me, on economic development with John. I'm actually looking forward to that. He came to the last chamber board meeting, and there was a good discussion there. So I think it's going to be a good beginning discussion. We'll get somebody else ready for that. And then we decided that we needed to have a regular meeting, or a special regular council meeting on August 24th to deal with other legislation and issues. So Melissa, it will be primarily a finance meeting with the finance session. What I talked to Melissa about was focusing on revenues, on revenue sources, on the levy. So we'll start to talk about the levy in May of 2016, talk about other possible revenue sources we have, look generally at the budget going out into the future, and you know, to talk about strategies for what we might want to do for future financial matters. And then we'll talk a little bit about the levy timeline. And John, this is after my frustration over these couple of pieces of legislation, knowing that you're leaving, I would think we absolutely have to have those two pieces of legislation on that agenda. I hope that that can happen. I don't know if you all know that those have been put off.
Which one?
The alley vacations.
The alley vacations, yeah. With Antioch College. Mm-hmm. So those have been put off because we're just trying to get work done. But I think those absolutely have to be completed before John leaves, because he's been working very closely on those.
I don't know that the people know that John is leaving.
Yeah.
Okay. Now.
Oh, well.
Well, maybe just announce it.
Would you like me to go ahead, or would you?
Go ahead.
Earlier today, John had a conversation with me. He will be leaving the village and accepting a position with a private consulting firm in Cincinnati, where he can do real estate and economic development in over the Rhine. Would you like to?
Downtown, actually.
Downtown.
Yes. Okay, I take it. Okay, well, this is an excellent opportunity. I just couldn't pass up to be basically the number two in a private consulting firm to work on downtown retail and housing court studies and plans in conjunction with the city of Cincinnati. You know, this, I appreciate my time at the village. I believe that my position is an excellent position. I love being here, and I have enjoyed meeting and getting to know everybody up here in the village and working on the things up here in Yellow Springs. This is, once again, an opportunity that it's hard to pass up. My girlfriend is in over the Rhine in Cincinnati. And I have a lot of things that I had worked on when I was down there. So evaluating those things, it seemed like the right opportunity to take.
And we will miss John very much, but I understand the opportunity is just too good for him to pass up. So.
And I will be here until Labor Day. So we'll be working really, very diligently to finish up the things that I started. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, John. We appreciate all your work.
So we are are ready to adjourn here. We'll be moving into rooms A and B to continue our work session about police issues. Chris, should we? We need to adjourn this meeting. Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you, Judy.
You're welcome. Okay, welcome everyone. This is the Monday, July 20th work session for the Yellow Springs Village Council. We're here to talk about the police process, policing in Yellow Springs, and see what the discussion of council vision on local policing policy. We do have an announcement to make. Are we going to do roll call? We do need to do roll call. I keep forgetting this is our second meeting. It's actually our third meeting, so. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Winthrop?
Here.
Esslin?
Yes.
Sims?
Here.
Hausch?
Here.
McQueen?
Here.
Also present are Chief of Police Jay Hale, Solicitor Chris Connor, and Village Manager Patty Gates, Assistant Village Manager John Young.
We do have an announcement. It's an exciting announcement that I'm going to turn over to our village manager, Patty Bates.
And let me just stand up because it's kind of one of the things that I truly enjoy doing in my job is promoting someone or hiring someone and giving them the opportunity to come and work for the village. And as everyone knows, Joe Bates, who was our superintendent of water and wastewater, recently resigned to accept a position in Xenia. So we did a search, and we decided, or I should say I decided, on an internal candidate, Mr. Brad Ault, who is with us this evening. And Brad, if you would come on up. Brad is our new superintendent of water and wastewater. Brad has been with us for 8 years.
Yes.
8 years. He has a Water 1 license and a Wastewater 2 license. And has a lot of experience, and it's kind of a family thing with him to be in public service, and particularly in water and wastewater management, as his dad works for Xenia. And so, Brad, welcome as our new superintendent. Brad has with us tonight his wife as well as his mom and dad. Somebody to replace him as one of the other operators, and also to continue in planning the building of our water.
Yes.
So he'll be busy.
And I'm looking forward to the opportunity.
Thanks.
Right, Brad.
And Brad has been involved in all of the visits and all of the work so far that we've been doing in the water treatment plant, so there won't be, he won't have a learning curve at all. He's been involved in all of the tours and in all of the decision making.
And so I have no doubt that Brad is going to do an exceptional job for us. No doubt.
Thank you.
The only thing you're not allowed to do is, you know, you have to leave those buildings painted, all those buildings.
Thanks, Brad. Congratulations.
Thanks.
So, do you want to review the two pieces of petitions?
So we had two letters that were specific to this topic of conversation, policing in Yellow Springs. We had a letter from Kate Hamilton. She's expressed particular concern about the ACE task force and believes that council needs to act now to make a decision about our involvement with the ACE task force. And Nance Parent and Sabrina Jewett wrote a letter thanking Officer Brian Carlson, for exceptional service.
Great. So the discussion of council vision on local policing policy, we have a pretty detailed agenda. What we're going to do is we're going to start with hearing from council member. Each council member will have up to 5 minutes to give their own perspective on issues regarding the Yellow Springs Police Department. Then we'll have just a general go around the table to kind of summarize that and to talk about common threads, values that have been presented, and to talk about a vision for policing in Yellow Springs. Then we will hear from Chief Hale, and we will dialogue with Chief Hale regarding any issues that have been raised and some of the materials that he's presented. We'll get some community input, and then we'll have some more dialogue. So we're expecting this, we have about an hour and a half allocated for this discussion, and then we will have some little bit of business after that too. We'll have our standing reports from our commission representatives. So I'm going to begin the discussion because I want to clarify my comments from the last council meeting. And I apologize for reading, but I do that because I want to make sure I don't miss any details. I don't consider the Yellow Springs Police Department hands-off to council when it comes to policy and budgetary issues. What concerned me about the proposed agenda and throughout much of this discussion has been connecting the Yellow Springs Police Department to the broader national issues of the militarization of the police, abusive officers, and extreme prejudice. I simply don't think those issues or attitudes reflect our department, and it offends me and damages our staff when those kinds of descriptions are used. I appreciate the materials Chief Hale provided for the packet, including his responses to the previous forum and the policies and procedures manual. After reading those documents, hearing from him and other staff, and talking to many citizens, it is clear that there is a dramatically divergent view of our police department from those who support it and those who don't. Council has a responsibility to listen to all and determine what policies fit best for our community. I've seen a big change in the police department under the leadership of Chief Hale. He's embraced the community and the values that set us apart from other places he has worked. But at the end of the day, he and his staff have sworn to uphold the laws of the state and village, and that's what they're trying to do. We have to recognize that local, national, and world events have necessitated changes in law enforcement that are out of our control. It would appear that nationally and statewide, there is finally recognition that the tactics have gone too far, with some police departments coming closer to resembling an army than public safety. I realize that in the recent past, our own department was moving closer to this type of force than anyone was comfortable with, but the changes under Chief Hale have reversed that direction. The two issues that seem to have caused the greatest concern are SWAT and the ACE Task Force. As Chief Hale has said, we aren't currently involved with SWAT and he has no plans to be. But to think we can or should create a policy to never allow a SWAT team in Yellow Springs, I don't think that's something that is council can or should do. Regarding the ACE Task Force, every chief since Chief Brody first joined the task force and supported the village, maintaining our involvement, and council has supported that request. I respect that all of our chiefs have felt it an important countywide collaboration that is aimed at reducing crime far beyond simply drug offenses to include sexual assault and child pornography. But at this point, the lack of support from citizens and the budgetary issues we are faced with require council to look more closely at whether the task force remains a good fit for Yellow Springs. I expect that this decision will be made with the 2016 budget later this year. I believe it is imperative for us to maintain our own local police department to best serve and protect our residents, businesses, and visitors while remaining mindful of community values. I also believe it is our responsibility as employers to keep our employees safe, so I will be mindful of the recommendations of our police chief when it comes to staffing levels. While we are a community of only 3,500, we can double or triple that population on a nice weekend and even more during major events. We have an active downtown with nearly 100 shops and restaurants and 3 banks, all of which are vulnerable, as we've already seen with robberies at 2 of our major banks. And while small, we aren't isolated, as we are located on a major state route that brings problems from other communities to our doorsteps. As I wrap up, I want everybody to know that I will be considering these issues and our decisions thoughtfully. We had an incredibly unfortunate incident that hasn't and doesn't need to define us. I want Yellow Springs to have a professional police department that protects and serves the community and reflects our values. And I want the community to take pride in the work they do. I don't know who wants to go.
I can go, please. I support a lot of what Karen said. I start by saying, we all have a right to trustworthy, honorable police service. Any breach in trustworthy, honorable policing needs to be acknowledged, dealt with, and some attendant recompense. We need a police force that is focused on protecting and serving all our citizens, regardless of perceived race or age, and who prioritize knowing the community and its people as individuals. Having met and spent quite a bit of time with Chief Hale, and at least some time with all of the officers, I believe they're committed to that goal. And I've got kind of a long passage here from Ta-Nehisi Coates' new book, Between seen The World at Me. I'm a big fan, so I bought it and read it this week when it just came out. And it's addressed to his son about growing up in America where it's traditional to destroy the black body and its heritage. He had lost a college friend to an undercover officer's terrible, misguided, cross-country line pursuit, county lines pursuit. And he was a black officer in a majority black county with a majority black police force. Coates cautions us against too simple scapegoating of police as a primary problem, saying that at this moment, the phrase police reform has come into vogue, and the actions of our publicly appointed guardians have attracted attention, presidential and pedestrian. You may have heard the talk of diversity, sensitivity training, body cameras. These are all fine and applicable, but they understate the task and allow the citizens of the country to pretend there's a real distance between their own attitudes and those of the ones that appointed to protect them. The truth is that police reflect America in all of its will and fear. Whatever we might make of this country's criminal justice policy, it can't be said it was imposed by a repressive minority. He finishes by saying the problem with the police is not that they are fascist pigs, but that our country is ruled by majoritarian pigs. And I said, now I think most of the Ellis Springer see us as distinct from this majoritarian pigs policy. And I actually gave my example of my own life. I'm going to skip that part. But a lot of us moved here and could have lived in, I could have lived in Springfield. I could have chosen to live in a majority non-white community. I could have lived in a majority black community. I don't feel totally pure, in other words, about my relationship to policies of white flight, things that have happened that have contributed to the problems there. And I think a lot of us can't. I think we rightly want police protection we can trust, but I think especially those of us on the liberal left, and especially those of us who are white and older, like me, have to avoid just scapegoating the police so we can feel more self-righteous. The police protection we want is entangled with policies that have been passed under our community's watch, and both Democrats and Republicans have supported them. And they are largely not the responsibility of the police themselves, particularly as individuals. People have every right to come at public policymakers, even with anger, and in a small town, we're authority figures who are accessible. And so I expect that we're going to be a place where anger can be expressed, and I hope that this can actually be a safe place for people to express anger and frustration that may be tied to things that are sort of outside our reach, or at least outside of our immediate reach. Yellow Springs is not a bubble. We are entangled with federal and state policies that can't be changed by this council by fiat. And I think we should look seriously at the ACE task force for the same reasons Karen mentioned. But I think it demands a fair public hearing. I'm in the same position as her that I am leaning away from supporting it. I think that's where the community is. But I want us to look at it carefully and see what it's doing. I also believe the police should listen to the community's desire to have their presence in front of the male salon at the beginning of the day. This desire has been persistently expressed, and their presence there is seen as a great value. I don't think it's a strong argument that criminals might use that time to commit crimes elsewhere. Most of the crimes in this town are domestic crimes, interfamilial. And the best thing, and a lot of the bad things that can happen, a random shooter, are not things that police can, that anybody can be 100% safe from in a country that has the gun policies that we have. So what our police, as I see it, what I hope for and what I believe Chief Haley admitted to, is that they're, when they're at a street fair, or when they're out on the street at the July 4th, or just making the rounds and being with people, is making sure that they're doing what they can to make sure people feel like they're there to help, to serve, and protect. And obviously that can be super complicated.
And I believe the police have a right to self-defense. I think they understand their job is dangerous and they put them in harm's way. I've never met an officer who didn't understand that. But I do think when many unarmed people, especially young people of color, are being killed in the country or left without proper medical care, I'd like us to ask some hard questions about the kind of police training that's happening. I read some of the things that Chief Hale said. I feel like I need to understand them better because what is happening is we've got a lot of children, even teenagers, men or families who are being shot in when they're walking around a Walmart or when they're playing in a park. And it hasn't happened right here in town, but the training concerns me, and that's what I want to ask some hard questions about. And I'm especially concerned about the concerns about prompt medical care that have also been a part of a lot of the concerns around the country, and making sure that it's very clear that even if somebody has committed a crime, even if we're sure they committed a crime, they don't. A police officer should ideally not be judge, jury, and executor, and they certainly should be giving prompt care even to people who have done something wrong. Let me close by saying the police have a very important and challenging job. The officer on the street does not create the conditions of their employment. They do not make the policies that shape these issues. They do not decide on their training. These are policy issues, and policymakers are largely to blame for creating the environment where bad things can happen. Further, I believe that as a country we should pay officers more, that they should get, especially when they need to get further training in dealing with increasingly complicated cases of mental illness, of unconscious racism, and de-escalating a violent situation. They should be more well compensated than probably we can afford. And we're trying to do what we can, but I do think it should be a job that recognizes the difficulty of it. And mostly that means we need to demand that the state of Ohio and federal government invest more in local communities and emphasize strategies for nonviolent interactions with the public. Thank you.
Mary Ann, Brian, whichever of you want to go next.
Okay. Stand up, just better. Speak up too. I think that this is a difficult discussion to have because it's very easy for it to get polarized, for people to be defensive and people to be offensive. And it's difficult because we're talking about people, individuals. We have a police officer at the back of the room and one sitting up here. So we're talking about people, we're not talking about uniforms. And we're talking about all of us too. And we have different perceptions. We all have had different experiences, we have different values, we have different perceptions, and there's a lot that we don't know. So it's difficult to do this. And one thing that I think is most important as we're talking is to be respectful. If we want police officers to be respectful to us, I'm talking as a citizen, then I think we also need to be respectful to police officers. A cop is not a cop is not a cop. A cop is a human being. And so what I'm hoping we can be looking at is policy. What kind of policy do we want in this village? What kind of policy do we want that reflects our values? And how do we want that policy to be enforced? So as I look around the room, I see a number of people younger than myself, and I see people my age. And some of the people my age I know have lived here even longer than I have. But I moved here in the early 70s, so, and council up here, Jerry as well, Jerry and I were here at that time. So I'm remembering what it was like back in the 70s. And my memory is that Well, you didn't necessarily like individual officers, and you didn't necessarily like what they did. You knew them, and they knew you. And that made a huge difference, because we weren't just looking at a suit, we were looking at a person. And we're not there now. Times are different, it's almost 50 years later, we can't go back to 1970. But as I've been trying to think of what was of value then, of course, knowing and being known was really important. And so I think as much as we can think about this, both as citizens and as a department, and I know Chief Hale has been doing this, how can we increase that knowing and being known part? The other thing that I feel like I remember, and other people can, is that I saw the officers more. I don't know why that is, but I would see them. And there were fewer of them, too, I think. There were probably about half the number. So that made it easier to sort of know and be known. But I think what we want is to have a positive relationship between the police department and the community, that the community trusts the police, that they turn to the police, that they know that the whole reason why we have a police department is to increase the safety of the community. That's and so if we don't have a positive relationship, we're actually working against that safety. So what I'd like to address briefly is the things that I think have been mentioned by the community that they would like to see, or at least that they have as concerns. So one of the first things that has been talked about is our involvement in the ACE task force, or the drug task force, I'll call it. I do think we should get out of it. I think that the whole drug policy, the whole war on drugs, has created more problems than it has solved. It has certainly not solved drug abuse. I think we probably have as much or more. And it's created criminals of people that shouldn't be criminalized, and it's treated what is really at heart a social issue as a criminal issue. And I would much rather see us use our resources in the village and, of course, statewide and regionally and nationally to deal with drug on a social issue rather than as a criminal issue. Another thing that's been mentioned is the CIT training. And probably citizens haven't seen all of the material that Chief Hale submitted, which includes a number of policies that he has instituted, or at least made in written form. But one thing that he has indicated is that he plans on having all the officers have that full 40-hour CIT training. And I think that that's really important, because so much of what police have to deal with here are people, whether it's drug or meth-induced or mental, it's that kind of interaction where they have to think quickly. And so that is what that training is helpful for. I think another thing that people have talked about are ways that the police can engage with the community. How can we have more positive relationship, in particular with youth? And for example, and Chief Hale and I have talked about this, having a class in the high school that the police officers are involved in to help high school students understand what are their rights and what are their responsibilities, so that we can be educated. Adults probably can use this too. One thing that has been mentioned, and I don't know where I stand on this, is to have some kind of citizen review board. The idea is, where can a citizen, if a citizen feels they have been abused by the police, some people are afraid to go to the police to talk about it, because that's where it happened. Now, they can go to Patty, they can go to a council person, but a citizen review board would be another place where they can go. I'm not sure that I support that, but I'm mentioning that because that was brought up, and that serves to have that kind of safe place. The last editorial in the paper said, do we need the number of officers that we have? I don't know if we do or not. I think we have definitely more officers than when I moved here, in the 70s. The population was higher. Antioch College was higher. Yes, we didn't have the tourism, but we certainly had problems. The village has been pretty wealthy over the past years, and so it's been easy to increase the number of officers. Do we need the number of officers? Does having the number of officers we have make it sort of easier for them to do things that maybe they wouldn't even need to be doing if we didn't have so many officers? I don't have an answer to that, but I do think that that's something the council should look at, probably not this year, but in coming years, to get an idea of especially considering our budget, but not just budget, policy too. And then the last thing that I just wanted to talk about was there is a certain culture in Yellow Springs. Not everyone in Yellow Springs goes along with it, but that culture is sort of laissez-faire. And we have some laws that are in place that we ignore as long as it's not causing a problem. An example, we have a leash law. People are supposed to have their dogs on a leash. But routinely now, especially since Antioch has the farm where the golf course used to be, people go to Ellis Pond and they let their dogs run around Ellis Pond. Now, and they self-manage that. Now, do we need to have officers going to Ellis Pond and telling people to put their dogs on leashes? Actually, I don't think so. I support the sort of laissez-faire use of the laws that if it's not causing a problem, it's okay to ignore it. But we have to deal with it, because I think when officers lived here and they knew people, then you know it was sort of accepted. But if officers don't live here and they don't sort of know those values, and the village government hasn't agreed upon those values, then officers don't know where to stand. The same is true of, like, apparently we're not supposed to be in parks after dark, but there are some people who have insomnia or whatever and go into the park after dark. Should they be kicked out of the park after dark? I don't really think so. Another example is if you have a joint in your car and you get stopped, is that any more dangerous to have a joint in your car than going 10 miles over the speed limit? I don't think so. And I think that in cases like that, people should be given a warning rather than being arrested. But that's me. That's one council member. The last thing that has been brought up is about mayor support. We can't deal with that tonight, but it is something that I think council needs to look at. And I think the concern about mayor's court is that as much as possible, we want to keep the decision-making process, how these things are resolved as local as possible. And so while we probably won't be dealing with that tonight, I do think that is something that council will be dealing with.
So I guess just to give some context, some of you know that until recently I was the council liaison for the Human Relations Commission. So I was very actively involved in the planning and the discussions around the October 23rd local policing forum, which was amazing. Ironically, we recently found out that in 1994, so 10 years prior, we had almost an identical forum and the same kinds of issues were raised.
20 years.
Oh, 20 years, thank you. Yeah. I thought I was good at math. All right. I guess one of the things that I want to emphasize, and Marianne touched on this, we've mentioned it in many council meetings, is what I perceive this discussion to be about. And I think it's important that council creates this vision, as Marianne pointed out, so that we can then give better direction to Chief Hale and our officers. But also, a while back, we decided that it was a bit premature to just jump in and start tackling issues like the ACE Task Force or Mayor's Court or some of these other things. So
in our minds, I think it's very important that we sort of validate and formally agree on what these values are for the community. We've got a lot of input from both the forums, the community conversations to do that. I guess an example, since I'm not sure that this has been clear for everyone, is if we decide that safety is the priority, then that can then help us make the decisions about some of these issues and do they preserve the safety of our village, which a lot of villagers have told me that's number one in their mind. Is cost one of the main priorities? I mean, there are lots of different things that we need to understand so that we can make good decisions. Subsequent to the October 23rd local policing forum, which we reference a lot, council made it clear that we would have this discussion at a council meeting to validate some of these things, and I don't find it to be repetitive at all. I mean, there's been lots of information gathering, and now is the right time to do that. I think it's also important to remember, and I was actually part of the police chief hiring committee, that we started that hiring process after that forum. And even though council had not formally accepted those village values, village manager Patty Bates agreed that should direct the decision-making process. And when we decided to hire Chief Hale, it was based on understanding that input from citizens. A couple things that I think are important to point out then are, for example, with issues like what's happening at Mills Lawn. It was really exciting to participate in a meeting with Chief Hale and Principal Hausch to talk about how we can do a better job of the police officers covering Mills Lawn. And it was pointed out that we need to be a little more strategic, that some of the practices in the past, which looked very good, didn't necessarily preserve the safety of the children. And so we've been really working on that. We have lots of ideas and that sort of, in my mind, is what I see as far as the breath of fresh air, a real responsiveness to those values that the community talked about on October 23rd. I guess another thing that had come up at our last meeting and I wanted to address, because it really was ironic to me, was a comment that was made by a citizen about an officer at the July 4th fireworks that appeared to be scary because he looked a little bit intense. And it was notable to find out that was our own Officer Meister, who we all know is a very friendly guy. And it sort of emphasizes to me what I heard a couple council members say so far about this idea of respect and communication being a two-way street. And that we need to understand, I think, as citizens, that if we're concerned about an officer, Chief Hale has an open door policy. We can also meet and greet that officer. And I know that one of the things that we will continue to do on the village level is have opportunities for citizens to meet and get to know people better. But I guess all of this to me highlights the fact that it's not so clear cut. I mean, we talk about things like we are a very safe community and crime is low, so why do we need officers? But the flip side of that is it seems logical to me that those officers and them doing a good job are the reason why we have such a safe community. So just sort of translating ours into, you know, this is what we need or don't need, it's a lot more complicated than that. And that's again where I think understanding what our vision is and what we want out of a police department is how we're going to make the best decisions. I guess the other thing that we need to keep in mind about, you know, things like cutting our officer staffing is the things that we would lose, like all the things that are not criminal related that our police officers do that I get the impression most citizens really value. I thought it was very interesting, and I would encourage everyone to look at the details that Chief Hale provided when he pointed out that in May of this year, the police department handled 1,300 calls for service. Only 10 of them led to arrests, and it goes on to say one of those was actually physically arrested and booked. So that to me explains a lot about the service that I would say our peacekeepers provide in this community. And that leads me to, I guess, delineate a little bit between understanding that it's reasonable to me why a lot of things have stirred up currently, and maybe something happened 20 years ago that also did that on a national level. But I think it's also important to distinguish the reality of what's actually happening in Yellow Springs. And I think there, looking at facts and looking at the character of this police department is really important. I mean, overall, most of the things that we see in our packet are very favorable comments. There was one written complaint that came about the police department. So I guess I don't want to lose that perspective, that certainly we can continue to improve, but I do not believe that things are as bad as they are in most other municipalities. Let's see. I don't want to repeat things that I think have already been talked about. I will read this. I do want to say that I'm primarily concerned that if we do not recognize the progress that is being made, it is likely that the YSPD team will become discouraged. I don't want to see this happen. This was emphasized when we hired our new village manager. We need to be supportive and constructive as a community so that we achieve the ideal that we are striving for. As always, I want to thank citizens for raising concerns and bringing important points such as youth engagement and restorative justice to light. Council members certainly need this input to make the best decisions for the entire community. And I think that covers the high points.
Okay, I'm on standing up. I didn't have anything prepared and so forth. And unfortunately, I've been under the weather. And you can notice as I talk, my voice is going to change and go up and down and so forth. But as I look around the room, I see young, old, black, white, whatever, okay? I'm kind of like Mary Ann. I came here in the late 60s, and actually when I was in college. And then my family got married and we decided to stay here and so forth. I was here when Chief McKee was here. I was here when John Gordy was here. I also was here when we had three other chiefs that didn't last. Okay, so, yeah, the police in Yellow Springs is not easy. Okay. Finding the right individuals are not easy. We talk about our officers that may not live here and those that did. When I came here, the average cost of a house was around $16,000. Okay. The average cost of a house now is closer to $200,000. Okay. Some of you may not know, but a lot of our officers lived in the Green Metropolitan Housing. Okay. Because that's what they could afford with the salaries that they were given. So the laws have changed on residency. We can't really force individuals to live in a community and then work it. That's, you know, that's reality. Dayton ran into that same problem when they tried to say that all officers had to live in that. But, you know, it's the individual that you hire to do the job, not where they live. I've seen a big transition in the quality of officers that we had in the past and that we have now. We have gotten rid of quite a few officers that were not suited to what we like here in Yellow Springs. Okay? Most of you, as I look around, didn't know those guys, but they're no longer with us. But I think the key to this whole discussion is, yes, we all may have had some personal confrontations with police officers. I have. When I first came here, I was racially profiled and so forth. But as time went on and the officers got to know me and I got to know the officers, things have changed. One of the things that I did when I first got on council
is not only did I go out and work to repair a water main or ride with the guys that were plowing snow or helping the guys lay a power line, I rode with every police officer that was on the force. So I got to know them more as individuals versus police officers. But what I also noticed as I rode around our mile or two radius, that some of our citizens expose themselves, yeah, they may not know it or not, expose themselves to possible crime. Yeah. Our police officers drive through alleys, you know, they drive down the bike path, they drive by the college and so forth, and you would be surprised the number of people that are out 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning walking their dogs or just strolling, okay? We're a small community, but again, we do sometimes leave ourselves open to something that's undesirable. Human Relations Commission, which I was on as a citizen and then I was on as a council member, that was a place where people were comfortable coming and talking about the problems. But one of the things that we found in that was, well, you know, it's a public meeting and it should be televised. And we went through a big hassle there. That's when I saw a big change in the people feeling comfortable coming to a public body. They felt they lost that space, okay? So, yeah. That's one of the things we need to get back. Yes, there have been a lot of incidents that have been nationally broadcast that did not show favorable light on the police department. But how many times do you pick up a newspaper or turn on the TV or turn on the radio where they're talking about something positive that an officer has done? You know, we are a society that's, through our media, likes the glory. You know, we like to show the bad in an individual or a department or a group. Good does not get publicized. But I'm hoping as part of this forum that we put together, yeah, let's identify the issues that we need to correct. But let's also identify the issues that are good and why they are good and why we want to make sure that those things continue to grow. So, you know, I'm looking forward to a lively and a respectful discussion so that we as council can frame the policies that we feel we need to give our officers, men and women, the guidance that they need to move forward. But let's all understand, all these guys and gals, when they were hired, they took an oath that said that they would protect the community, they would respect the laws of the village, of the state, and of the federal government, okay? This is what they swore to when they pinned on that badge. So we have to support them in that respect to give them the guidance. And foremost, we want to make sure that every night or every afternoon when that officer comes in and signs into his shift, that he goes home to his family. And let's make sure that we don't do anything or write anything that will hinder that person's ability to return home after the shift.
So I think I'm actually, for this next part, I think I'll turn it over to Brian and Mary Ann to kind of facilitate how we're going to put together this, talk about this vision for the police department.
Well, I was just trying to find commonalities as we were talking, and it seems like maybe the biggest thing is about safety. That what we want from the police department is to keep people safe, and also that the police officers themselves are safe. That seems to me to be one piece. Another I think thing that was mentioned was about the police officers have to deal with people who are having various mental states, and that's important for our officers to be able to be trained in that regard. Working with children, the relationship of having officers having a relationship with children. So children are learning to see officers as, to trust officers and learning from them, and vice versa. Well, the other thing I think that was being said mostly was that we feel pretty good about the police department, that while there are things going on nationally that we're quite well aware of and are leading into our consciousness, if nothing else, that the kind of aggression that and abuse of force that is being put out to us nationally every day is not really present here. I mean, we have had a couple instances of some things, but basically that is not, certainly not the norm. So that's, what have you been hearing?
Yeah, I mean, I think in particular, when you mentioned the thing about people with different mental states, it reminded me of the core values that Chief Hale shared with us, and he added compassion, because my understanding is, Chief Hale, that was one that you kind of reflected on after hearing a lot of the feedback and thought was important.
And not even, I just felt it was important. I mean, clearly the feedback from the October meeting was an influence, but I think that's one of the things officers need to be, is sometimes as cops, you can sort of forget what it's like to be a citizen, because you go out and you do these things. And to understand every now and then that when you're not on duty, you are that citizen. And you may be the victim of a crime, or you may be the victim of hit and run. And if you can remember what that person is going through when they feel victimized, it makes you a much better officer all around. So I believe it's just a very, very important quality.
Yeah, I like that you added that. I think one that I think should be highlighted is the value of service. I mean, I have to believe that one of the things that we love about our local police department is all the things they do that are outside the traditional role. And the last thing I would highlight is the sort of locality kind of value, getting to know each other. And whether practically we're gonna have the majority of our officers live in the village, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not sure we have that interest locally for a lot of our citizens to want to be police officers. But we can still have that kind of value and sort of level of interaction. But I think that's a really good list. And in my mind, I don't know that tonight we will create that vision statement unless somebody has it in their mind. But I think we use those elements to put that short paragraph together. Because I almost envisioned that as council we would pass some kind of resolution that, you know, indicates exactly where we're at with this. So
the idea is, because in preparing the procedures manual, policy and procedures manual, Chief Hale did develop a mission statement and core values, which I think the vision statement is really at the top of that. So is that what we're looking to do, is to provide more of that community vision?
Yeah, well, I'll read the mission statement. says, the mission of the Yellow Springs Police Department is to provide the most professional police services possible, to be responsive to the needs of the community, to involve the community in decisions which directly affect them, and to provide the necessary services identified by the community as important. So really, it is saying that community, the police department is going to be taking the lead from the community. And
yes, so you have to take input from the community.
Yeah.
I believe there are some issues that clearly are law issues.
Yeah, yeah.
And even if the community feels a certain way, the law may contradict that. You may be limited. But clearly, we are affected by the community, by the input of the community, and it should influence how we proceed.
Well, I guess I'm going to throw out a question to council. Because something that I stated, that the Yellow Springs has tended to have some laws in place that are used when the law is being not followed in a way that's really harming someone or creating a big nuisance or something. But so I'll use the example of dogs at Ellis Park as an example, because I know that people now take their dogs to Ellis Park and they are not on leashes. But we do have a leash law.
Well, and I don't disagree with you that for the most part, dogs can be let off a leash. But on the rare occasion that the dog then attacks another dog or
right,
even worse, harms a child, then how do you enforce the leash law?
I don't have an answer to this, but I'm posing this question to council, that do we have that at least leaning toward the idea that we may have something in the statute somewhere, but that if people are practicing, let's say, taking their dogs to Ellis Park and letting them run and there's no problem, that we're not going to ask the police department to go and check on dogs at Ellis Park.
Has this been a problem? I mean, is that why you're bringing it up? Have people been cited?
Well, I'm just trying to, you know, keep my ear out. What are the kind of things I'm thinking about? So the older people are our age. Yes, this has been that I know someone who had a police officer at Ellis Park say your dog is supposed to, well, actually two people, your dog is supposed to be on a leash. And there was something else in the paper about someone walking at night at Gaunt Park, and they were told they weren't supposed to be at the park. I'm just using this as an example, though.
He's trying to get at the concept of, do we want to have that kind of a laissez-faire? It's tricky, right?
It is.
It's really tricky, and it's really hard for an officer to figure that out, right?
I know.
Don't like it when I'm walking down the street with my dogs on leashes, and suddenly a dog comes out. My dog's been attacked by loose dogs before, so I really kind of value having a leash law, particularly in my neighborhood.
From my perspective, and what I try to teach the guys, is you again, there is no double standard. Everything has to be above board. And if we're going to enforce the leash law in your neighborhood, you can't go over and go, well, yeah, that's only a beagle, so it's fine. But if you let the beagle go, then you gotta let the collie go. And if you let the collie go, you have to let the German Shepherd go. And if you let the German Shepherd go, you gotta let the pit bull go. So you either then to keep the misperception that we're picking on you because you have a collie and we let her go because she has a Shih Tzu, you can't do that. So you have to do it across the board. We have to be fair in our approach. So you either then let all dogs off the leash or you enforce the law.
You enforce the law when someone makes a complaint about it, which is how it's done.
Which is usually then after someone has been bitten.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know where you're getting on this, but I mean, I'm certainly not ready to start talking about getting rid of laws like leash laws, because I think those do infringe on people, on other people's rights, if you have a lot of loose dogs. So, I mean, I think we're getting in the weeds, and I don't understand why we're talking about.
Well, she's trying to get used to the weed of leash law.
I'm trying to give an example of how I think things have shifted from when we had officers who lived here and knew people. There was a bigger, there was more of a looseness. That doesn't exist now. So how do we, what do we do about
that? Yeah, I think what you're trying to get at is that you feel that that's within an officer's discretion. And I don't know that Chief would agree with you. Because part of the issue, if I'm understanding the public correctly, part of the issue is that there are certain citizens who feel like they're being targeted because they're African American, or you know, they're lower income or something like that, or they're out at the wrong time, or they're younger, and so they're feeling like they're targeted because of that. But you know, just to stay with your example, if you're the person who has the Doberman that's running at Ellis not on the leash, and someone is intimidated by your Doberman but not by her Shih Tzu, so you're told to put your Doberman on the leash but she's not told to put her Shih Tzu on, now you feel targeted because you have a Doberman. It's the same way with every law. The enforcement is the difficult part, because are there certain situations where you can have a little bit of give and take? Yes, but you can't tell the police department to blanket across the board, loosely enforce laws, because if you do that, then you're going to end up with uneven enforcement.
And that uneven enforcement can easily fall on
the wrong folks.
And it can
disadvantage classes.
If I may be incorrect on this, but if I look through most of the calls and reports, and I believe we've had one person who actually may have faced a mayor's court charge on the dog, and I think that individual was warned twice before.
Right.
Everyone else has received warnings. But when you get someone who's been warned twice, and on the third time they do it again, the officer chose then to enforce it with a mayor's court citation. But it's not like we're going in, oop, you got a dog, and writing out tickets either. That is not happening. We are giving things, and a warning is a portion of enforcement.
And I guess that's the takeaway with this kind of example for me is, you know, if we have this sort of flexible laissez-faire, whatever, that, you know, what are we doing? You know, are we warning? And I know there's another incident about the direction you parked down the street, and we went back and said, okay, those will all become warnings. That I think is the value or principle that's important in my mind that maybe could be rolled into that vision. And then maybe in the future we look at the leash law, but you know, that's way down the line.
And when we do the dog park? That's the takeaway from this discussion.
Well, the other thing is, you know, years ago, and I remember when the leash law went into effect, okay? And it was basically saying that having the ability to control your dog, okay? So there are a lot of dogs, people are out with the dogs, they have a leash on, okay? But the dog still may be running kind of loose, okay? But that individual knew their dog, and they knew how much room to give their dog, okay? And so the leash was there, it may be dragging behind the dog, but it was that individual that says, hey, I'm gonna take responsibility now. If my dog does something, I know the law that says that he has to be on a leash, I have to be able to control them, okay? And I've ridden with officers and so forth, and we've seen people out running their dog. They have a leash attached to the dog. So that says to me, and it also says to the officer, that person can control that dog. Mm-hmm. Now, the other issue that we were looking at is Alice Pond or being in parks after dark, okay? There's a big difference in being in the park after dark in the wintertime and being in the park after dark in the summertime. In the wintertime,
Most of the leaves are gone off of the trees, and as officers drive by, they can see a great distance. Come spring and summer, where our trees, the foliage starts to come in, then you got problems, okay? So, you know, there's leniency that can be used, and also there's a little bit of common sense and so forth, you know. Yellow Springs is not diverse from various types of crimes we don't want to talk about, okay? But I, for one, as I said, I've ridden with the officers and so forth, and I see people out at 2 or 4 o'clock in the morning jogging and so forth. Jogging by, and we've got a lot of parks, jogging by the park, you as an individual can't see what might be lurking in the dark, okay? Our police officers had that same thing. And again, we have to remember that we are hiring the officers first to protect us, okay? And, you know, while we may like things, we still have to take into fact that there aren't always people that have the same objectives and so forth in mind that we do. And again, the time of year. So, you know, maybe we can be flexible, but we also have to be safe.
I mean, personally, I think that what Chief said about warnings, I think that I don't think that there is a problem with a police officer asking somebody who is at Gaunt Park at 3 o'clock in the morning, just saying hi to them and asking them why they're there. I mean, I think that that is a legitimate question. Do they have to be told to leave? Do they have to be taken in, arrested, even given a warning? I think it's a question, and I think it's knowledge. I think it's protecting that person, and it's protecting the rest of the citizens. So, I mean, I think getting into these, you know, what laws we're going to enforce and what laws we aren't, I think for us is getting into some pretty sticky territory. And I, you know, not really where I thought we were going to go tonight. I think it's much more specific than I thought we were going to go. So I don't know, what do you all think about what to do, kind of where to take, since it's your agenda, where do you think about taking this next?
Well, I mean, just, I was using that, trying to use that as an example. I did want to say one other thing, because that particular example was sort of more about people our age. But I did do appreciate a policy that Chief Hale wrote about traffic enforcement practices. And I just wanted to mention a couple things, because I thought it was interesting to me, and I appreciated it. The first thing is that it says that the most effective way to deter traffic law violations is through a visible patrol car in a marked vehicle to prevent the violation rather than to catch someone violating. And I didn't know that, and I appreciated learning that. The other thing is that is stated is to take immediate enforcement action upon observing a violation. To favorably alter the violator's future driving behavior, to make a change in their driving behavior. And I mention that because I know that there have been concerns about people feeling followed, whether they're in a car or not. So I think that this policy.
And enforcement action, again, is a warning. It does not necessarily mean mm-hmm. a citation. It does not necessarily right. mean charging them for crime. But if you see a violation, you can give them a verbal warning. That is considered an enforcement action by policy.
But in answer to your question, Karen, I mean, so we've never done this before. So how do you do something you've never done? You know, you do it and you find out how it goes. If Brian is interested, I would be willing to continue working with him to develop a draft vision statement and to use the same kind of process we've been using and come back.
I don't think we should all be sitting here wordsmithing a vision statement, no.
But I think we've gotten an amazing amount of feedback information, examples, that we can make a good go at that draft and then continue to discuss it. So,
Karen, could I comment? Many years ago, I was a public defender in Dayton, and I participated in a similar process there as a public defender representative. And I think that, one of the things that I'm hearing that's been implied but not stated, but probably has been said before in a different context, and in my participation almost 20 years ago in a similar event, was what we're talking about is the concept of criminal justice, because most people aren't upset about their encounters with police officers because they've called to say, I need help. So by definition, what happens is that most people's first contact with the criminal justice system, whether it's a traffic ticket, the leash, whatever it might be, is because the show of authority that comes from the uniform and the badge is what is in the encounter begins with. And that that experience is how most people identify their interaction and their perception of the police. And what came out of this meeting 20 years ago was, at least my takeaway was, I didn't always sense in a larger police force in Dayton that the officers were always sensitive to the impact of the power of the uniform and the badge. Now, that said, I wasn't sure that the citizens who were expressing their concerns were always sensitive to the role of the police officer and how they, the police officer often viewed that encounter. Now, it's not fair to compare a larger city to the village of Yellow Springs in the context of the criminal component of what's going on here, because it's a much safer community by definition. But it seems to me that if you had a show of hands to say, how many people in this room have had an encounter with a police officer under a color of authority because you've been stopped for some reason and asked a question? My guess is almost everyone would raise his or her hand. Then if you said, how many of you were intimidated by that act? I think almost everybody would raise their hand. How many of you would have been to say, I was pleasantly surprised with how the encounter ended because the officer gave me a warning or let me go? And how many of you has that happened to? I mean, I've been let go of speeding tickets, and my sense was, boy, I don't believe that was very nice of the officer to do that. At the same time, I've been given tickets that I probably deserved, and I got a ticket at least one time I can remember I didn't deserve. And what I remember the most was that the attitude of the officer and how that encounter started defined my experience. And I certainly have had some unpleasant experiences in the context of my life growing up, particularly in my youth, when I wasn't particularly sensitive to the police officer side of the equation. And so it seems to me what I'm hearing but haven't heard directly is this common ground, finding the common ground that says, let's be sensitive to one another's perspectives and the role that we play. To address one of the things that you said, Karen, and it's really the one thing that's come up with that I cannot address from a legal perspective, police officers do have the right to come up to someone and ask for, why are you here, etc., in a, without any probable cause or even reasonable suspicion. It's called the common law right of inquiry. The citizen doesn't necessarily have to respond to those questions, but that may or may not, I don't want to use the word escalate, but it could drive a different layer of dialogue. So I share that with you to say, are we looking at the discussion from the right beginning point, which is to address the sensitivities of the perspective of individual citizens with the role of a police officer? I suspect that we have, but I haven't heard those words, and I share that experience with you because I thought it might help facilitate the conversation a little bit.
I think what I expect to come out of these sessions, and maybe Chief as well, what we are looking for is council's direction that you want us to guide the department. You know, we understand some of it. We understand that, you know, I don't think Chief ever intended to give everybody a citation, and that it's, you know, while he does leave it to officer discretion, which you do have to leave a certain amount of it to officer discretion to judge the encounter and the facts of the encounter and the demeanor of the encounter. But I think that, as he has said, there is verbal warnings, written warnings. There are other methods of enforcement that don't require an actual citation that goes on a record to get somebody to court. And so I think what I was looking for, at least, or hope to get out of these, is the general direction that council wants the department to go, as a village entity. Chief, did you want to?
I think maybe take a look. When the original one happened, I was here all of 7 weeks or 21 days or something very, very short like that. I think take a look at what we have done and then move toward those goals. And, there's things that I can tout that I believe we're still doing and moving toward them. And a critique of where we've been, where we're going, and where you want it to be in the future.
Do you have a kind of a prescribed what officers say when they stop? I mean, do you have a protocol?
Yes.
And a specific speech, if nothing else, officers approach?
On traffic stops, yes. On traffic stops, the standard thing is you go up, you introduce yourself, you tell them the reason for the stop. Although the cameras do not work 100% of the time, they work 90%+ of the time. I do review those intermittently, and these officers pretty much nail it each and every time. And I've shown you guys some of the stops if they want to come in. It is there. One of the policies that when you start dealing with other crimes, police officers do have the ability to lie to people. If you're a burglary suspect and I see you in the middle of the street, I may not go, "Hi, will you come with me? You're a burglary suspect," because you're likely going to run. So they do have the ability in certain situations to persuade people without full disclosure, but departmentally discourage that unless you can rationalize why you did. And again, I've got to give the officers quite a bit of discretion. If it's something very, very simple like jaywalking, you want to tell them it's something else, that doesn't make sense and that would not fly.
Now, that's the law we can't enforce. At least not in front of Tom.
One thing I did want to address is that during the comments, Lori, I think you said the training, how officers were trained was something that you wanted to understand better in relation to the national events that occurred. And some of them are because that's the way the officers are trained. But if I'm not mistaken, there is a move underway, not only nationally, but also in the state of Ohio, to revamp the curriculum to change that, to make these incidents less likely to happen.
Through the Attorney General's office, there is the Ohio Peace Officer Training Academy, OPATA, and there are minimum standards that officers have to have. There are certain things you have to do each and every year. Predominantly what the Attorney General has done is ramp those up quite a bit. When you originally go through the academy, there are required numbers of hours in each field. CIT is one of those, and it's in a block of like 72 hours, but it does not necessarily mean you get the 40-hour class. So anybody who has went through the academy in the last 20-plus years has some degree of CIT training. Dennis Nipper, myself, we're older. We have not been through that, although I've had some things through the sheriff's office that to deal with those types of situations, but clearly not the 40-hour school that we want to get everybody to.
So in there, I do know that when Attorney General DeWine came and read his report on the Paul Shank incident, that he really identified the lack of training and the lack of mental health training as a huge issue for police, and something that I clearly think he wanted to address. And I think certainly after the incident in Cleveland and the incident in Beaver Creek, those incidents have certainly heightened his desire for, and that those incidents I don't think really were about mental health. It's more about response, how you respond to specific incidents, and is that, or are you hearing that that's going to be part of it also?
Yeah, clearly, and one of the things that when I went to the church back in the fall and we talked about men, I don't want to be insensitive to any of these acts that have the public upset. And I understand why the public upset, and some of them upset me. But this is not new. This is something that has went on for years. What is new is the advent of everybody having a camera on their hip and having access to it 24/7 via the internet. So a lot more people are seeing things that are happening. So the police are under tighter scrutiny, and I think that's a good thing. But with that, what has sort of happened in my career early on was the first well-paid police department, LAPD, the sheriff's office out there, had in-car camera systems. So for 20 plus years, even though the internet's been sort of on this for 7 or 8 years, I've been watching police officers die. And that sort of affected the training to a lot of what I say are like red light, green light scenarios, where you have an individual, they're behind the trunk of the car, you ask them to come to you, they tell you no, they yell some derogatory comments. Because of their aggressive nature, you probably put your hand on your gun, you order them out again, and they come out from behind the car. That scenario, he may have a cell phone, he may have a kid in his arm, he may have a gun in his hand, he may have a tire iron. And what is sort of, as the training developed, at least in my opinion, is it's as a either you shoot or you don't shoot scenario. And I think where I think the training needs to go is if he comes out with a gun, you know, what are your options? Instead of pop, 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 which is where the training currently is, and I think, you know, makes the situation worse, is what tactically can you do? What can you do to avoid still being in this? Where can you take cover? Where, you know, you evaluating that circumstances instead of going, oh, he's got a gun, I'm good to shoot him, which is not necessarily in the cop's head, I'm good to shoot him, but he hits that level where it is appropriate to use deadly force. Because despite what, and I'm not saying there aren't people out there, but I'll tell you this, somebody's, you know, mentions about a bad cop. Bad cops are very, very easy to spot as a chief of police. Cops that are good cops that make a bad decision are the problem, because they're everywhere. I've got two of them back here. They're good cops. That doesn't mean they can't make a bad decision. If they're bad cops, I can weed them out in a heartbeat, because they stick out like a sore thumb.
I'd like, Chief, you kind of touched on this a little bit. I think it might be helpful for council and the citizens if you could explain a little bit about how you want to change the mindset. You had talked about, you know, this is how officers are trained, and how are you going to get them from I'm okay to shoot to what are my other options? It's
most everything now is scenario-based training. And there are certain things, everything from turning targets and they can turn left and they're holding a badge, or they turn right and they're holding a gun. There are video machines predominantly that you walk in, known as FAT system, where you have a gun that shoots a laser pulse, et cetera, and it can tell you when you shot, where you shot, et cetera. And so they tell you to walk into this and here's somebody coming out of the bank, you know, wearing a mask. And that individual either stops when you tell him stop, police, and he raises a mask, dude, it's Halloween, relax, or he produces a gun, or he grabs a person, takes them hostage. The more you can get into that scenario-based training and give the police officers options besides, okay, this is okay for the deadly use of force, I think the better off we are. I've got the second of our officers trained as a firearm instructor. RJ Holly, and so again, the better trained we are, the more options we have, and that's where I want to sort of take it. And so, because if not, you're subject to whatever training we can get. Being a small agency, we don't have a 24-hour, 40-hour-a-week training officer, so we have to sort of improvise and do these things. And but we can control that, and that's where I'd like to go.
I'm thinking maybe it's the time to hear from citizens. Yeah, it's quarter after now, so Will, it's going to be a little strange here, I guess. I think we can probably, Susan, if they just stand up in their place, do you think we can all hear them if they just stand up at their seats?
Yes.
Okay, so raise hands. I'll be looking. I don't know, I'm blanking on names, Jeff. And so if I don't know your name, I apologize. I'll point at you. Jeff.
Hi, I'm Jeff Reich. I spent 17 years as night shift charge nurse in the busy trauma center in Dayton. I worked with a lot of police officers, been a volunteer paramedic here for a long time, worked with a lot of officers as well. I've written a number of letters to the editor in support of the officers' behavior in the past, but there's a couple of things that have been going on with, in our village with our department which concerns me. One, as to the county drug force, let me say that according to CNN, in 2010, our federal government spent about $10 billion on the war on drugs. States and local governments about $25 billion. In 1980, about 40,000 Americans were imprisoned for drug offenses. Today, that number is 500,000. And depending upon the year and the state, between 2.8 and 5.5 times higher rates for blacks over whites. Yet anyone today can still purchase any drug they wish at will. As prohibition of alcohol in the 20s was an utter failure, so too is our war on drugs. All it has accomplished is the growth of organized violent crime and imprisoning of Americans and shunning money from a way where it should be to help people in need of help. While I feel somewhat helpless to stop the complete stupidity and racist practices of the federal war on drugs, I must share that I am personally offended and utterly disgusted that our local tax money at Yellow Springs is being spent funding a full-time police officer in Greene County setting up undercover drug busts while having virtually no overall effect on the drug trade and certainly no effect on treating drug addiction or preventing drug use by our kids. And if Naomi Penrod's recent behavior is any demonstration of the aggressive and immature attitude that she perhaps learned from working with the drug task force, then I strongly suggest that wasting our money is not the only way that our being a part of this organization is hurting us. We want to spend our money training our officers how to interact with people with mental illnesses, learning nonviolent crisis intervention, learning alternatives to arrest when feasible, becoming experts on the law, learning non-deadly self-defense, and also the type of training that Chief Hale was just speaking of, and how to transition the overall approach of one of us versus them, which often happens when our officers don't live here anymore, to one of becoming guardians of our community. When Chief Hale came here, he spoke about the value of community policing, but according to an article in the newspaper, perhaps there was some misunderstanding in his understanding of community policing and what many of us believe what community policing is. To me, community policing is demonstrated when I used to see Officer Al Pierce standing every morning with the Mills Long Crossing Guard, greeting and speaking with every kid crossing the street, gaining their trust. Community policing is not seen when I've seen, sometimes lately, an unknown officer parked nearby, yet unseen, inside his or her heated or air-conditioned cruiser with the windows up. Community policing was demonstrated by Chief John Brody in greeting the crossing guards every morning with donuts, and by many seeing John or Al or Tom Jones or Dennis Knipper downtown pretty much every week, talking with people, listening to their concerns, getting to know people. I never saw Chief Bedford outside of his office during the entire time he was here. And frankly, sir, I've yet to see you outside this building. All I know, you've been outside more than the previous chief. I've heard really good things about what you're doing. I've heard good things about the morale in the department since you come, and I appreciate that. However, we used to have a chief, two sergeants, and many officers who lived here who had gone to our schools, sent their kids to our schools, shopped here, they were our neighbors. Now Dave Meister is the only full-time officer who's actually part of our community, and his strong desire to be part of the community he serves is so strong that he actually volunteers with our fire department as a firefighter and EMT who I've worked with. I'm not suggesting that Chief Hale and other officers seek volunteer positions in our community, but if they want to take our values of community policing seriously, they're going to have to do better at seeking out opportunities actively to get to know all of us and to allow us to get to know them. Get out of your cars and get out of the Bryan Center. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. Joe, I saw Mr. Lewis's hand up.
Yes, my name is Joe Lewis. Being one of the older members in the community, I've been here for more than 52 years. During that time, I think I've known most every police officer and many police chief and many of the officers. I've never had a bad experience from any police officer, chief, or many other citizens. So what we talk about police officers, people have bad impressions of police officers in one community or another community. We have to look at our community. I can't be concerned so much about the policing in Baltimore, New York, Los Angeles, other places, but our police officers here have always, in my estimation, been respectful, helpful, and ready to serve. We have response times. We are older people. My wife has gone to the hospital many times, and quite often it's in the evening, at night. The police officers are the first people there before the EMTs. So they're ready, and they're there to help you and serve you. In talking about and setting priorities for the ACE task force or whichever, I am not in favor of not having being involved with the ACE task force. I think there are values to being involved with the ACE task force. We can look at national statistics about drugs and the federal government's war on poverty, but when drugs hit you in your community, you want to be involved with eradicating it. And if that's the one means of doing it, I think that we need to take that into consideration and be willing to support that. Trying to micromanage a force, we've talked about different things. I won't get into the dog situation, but unleashed dogs are a problem, no matter where they are. And I was awakened once or twice in the last several years by a police officer telling me that some dog had upset my trash in the middle of the night. At that time, I think you want all dogs to be unleashed or be fastened up. So I think we have to look at the leash law as the way it was put in, the reason it was put in. I've seen, I remember got involved with two dogs that were fighting once, and they were not unleashed, and the lady who had one dog was bitten severely. So I think we have a criteria for policing, and I would hope that we wouldn't micromanage it so that you are not able to do what you need to do. Your officers have judgment, you need to exercise good judgment, and if there is a law, I think that we should respect the law and live with it until we come up with something better. I thank you.
Thanks, Joe. And I should have said, please state your name. I mean, we know you, Joe, so we just need Judy to be able to get.
Cheryl.
No, I'm sorry.
I'm Angel Nalubega. I'm a first year at Antioch. I go to Antioch. I co-opt here in town, and I'm back on campus now. And I haven't had negative experience with police until recently, very recently, last week. And I won't go depth into that, but I don't think the problem is. I don't know. I've only been here since October, since I got here, but I don't think the problem is the people. And I feel like there has to be introspection done on both sides, but the police actually have to do some looking into how they're policing and how they engage with the community, because I don't know who these police officers are. I don't know their names. If they've never engaged with campus community, they haven't engaged with me in a positive or negative way until recently. And I just think it's important to remember that it's not that, I think it's important to remember that Yellow Springs is Yellow Springs and it's a small town, but it's also a small town in the middle of all of these other bigger issues that are in, around. And just because this is Yellow Springs does not mean that like me as a woman, as a black woman, cannot feel unsafe. That doesn't mean that, like, that does not mean that Yellow Springs is excused from talking about these issues, that Yellow Springs is like an example of better, because it is nice here, and I feel, and then sometimes I feel safe walking around, but there are many times that I don't feel safe walking around when there are police. And it can be in the daytime, and it can be at night, but sometimes I don't feel comfortable with the police. And I feel like there is a reason as to why that is, and there is to be introspection and attention placed on the police as well as the community. But I think the responsibility falls on the police who are walking around and who are, who have a commitment to the safety of the community. The safety of the community is helped by when police tell their names and come up to people and actually like get to know people and not racially profile people, especially students, especially Antioch students. So that's all I want.
Thank you. Rose, I saw Rose next.
Firstly, oh, I'm Rose Paldell. Firstly, I was one of the people who stopped at Gaunt Park recently. I was not told the officer's name. I talked to Chief Hale about it afterwards and was very happy to find out that he also was unable to find the ordinance in which it states that being in a park after dark is illegal. There is supposed to be a sign at Gaunt Park, but it has been removed numerous times, not by the village. I just thought it was interesting that that wasn't brought up in the discussion, because I mean, I don't really see why our parks need to be closed after dark, but that's just that. I'd also like, I guess, I'm wondering what safe means. That's what our police officers are apparently supposed to be keeping us, and you know, how we keep people safe. A police force seems like the tools that they have are that they're looking for criminals to catch and to cite and to take away, right? I think that's just interesting in, you know, how we think about, you know, when people are walking around it in dark, you know, there might be unsafe for some unknown reason. I think that's an interesting thing to think about, like how are police keeping people safe? Also, the three things that are the like sort of police, what you're supposed to be doing, professional police service, responsive to the needs of community, and there was a third thing. It really sounds like council is supposed to be defining what those things mean. They're very open to interpretation, and I don't know if council has done that in the past, but I don't know what that means. And I would think that the people that we're paying to keep us safe should have more direction in what those things that are those three major things that they're supposed to be doing actually mean.
Thanks, Rose. Women in the back, sorry.
Yes, no worries. Cheryl Durgens. First of all, I want to say thank you for the service of the police when it comes to emergency situations. I have elderly parents, and having that presence of a first responder there is wonderful. However, with all due respect to the council and this conversation, dog leashes are first world problems. We had a whole conversation about a dog leash tonight. Not the focus we're here for. With all due respect to City Council, Ms. Wintrow, we have brothers in this room right now who could cross over into any county in Greene County and get shot. We are in Greene County. It is a racist county. Yellow Springs is part of Greene County.
We are part of this country. We are part of this community. And it is really, really poor form to think that we are in some isolated community where our community members are not in danger anywhere else. I really take exception to that. And that's all I have to say tonight.
Can I see your hand up?
Yes.
Oh,
thank you.
Good statement.
Yes, I'm John Hempling. Just to also echo with what Angel said, because we heard similar things back when me and my friend Johnny Noe did a video project about the relationship between the Yellow Springs youth and the police. One of the things that we were hearing from young people is that basically the only thing that they're afraid of in this town are the police, because the town is very safe, but police were definitely following us, as even the chief at the time acknowledged. I would say that definitely for counseling, and one of the best ways I think that you could help with this situation is to identify certain classes of infractions that the police don't really need to be enforcing. Like, that's a policy level decision. And also getting out of the ACE task force, that's a policy level decision. Some of these things, in terms of like how the police interact with the public, are, I think, a little bit out of the range of policy to perhaps influence. I guess that's more. And I would also like to agree with Rose that I don't see why we need to close our parks after dark. Our town is extremely safe, but it doesn't seem necessary. Also, to echo Marianne, on the one hand, drug enforcement causes like incarceration, which has all of these negative consequences. And on the other hand, it has no effect on drug use. Costs, no benefit. So.
Thank you,
John.
Anyone else?
My name is Liam Marine. I've lived here for 2 years. I go to Antioch College. But one thing I want to bring up is citizen review boards. And you guys are talking about, you know, possibly entertaining that idea. And I would like to know what steps we need to take to establish an efficient, citizen review board where there's more community input into who's, you know, policing us, as well as add a layer of accountability for those police who do step outside their bounds. And I know it's been expressed that, you know, there's a lot of problems with police nationally, and maybe they're not the case here, but I disagree with that, and I think that, you know, they might be more subtle here, but they're still apparent, and there's still room for, you know, injustices to occur. And I don't know, I just want to express a sense of urgency for, I don't know, establishing an efficient citizen review board.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'm here because I don't want somebody else to speak for me. This village has a history of speaking for and including everybody is thinking one way. I'm not thinking one way. The village provides us with safety. They owe us safety. I favor the task force. I don't use the pool. I don't use the skate park. I don't use these park funding programs, but I pay my taxes. I want safety. Our streetlights have already been turned down in power to save energy, supposedly. And we have very few streetlights in this town. I want my safety looked after, and I want my tax money to go for my safety and the police department. Thank you.
Thanks, Becky. Talis.
My name is Talis X. I don't think that we would ever be able to stop drugs here in Yellow Springs or Xenia or Cleveland County, Chicago. It don't matter where you are. So it don't matter how many cops or task force you bring in, people are going to continue to get high. I think that's just fact. I mean, bringing in undercovers and all of that, all of those things won't change anything. I've worked on both sides of it. I'm totally against it because I work with the task force. I was an informant, and it sucks, and it's not good, and there's nothing that's going to change anything. You know, that's not going to change anything. And I've been here for 3 years, and when I first moved in, I was followed around for a long time. I was stereotyped. One of the officers, when I had my work truck last year, was telling me that I'm going to jail because I'm not a valid driver until he got on that little radio on his chest and found out when he ran my social and everything else that I was a valid driver. Then tried to shake my hand after he found out that I was a valid driver, after he just told me that I was going to go to jail. He could prove that I was not a valid driver. You know, I'm not saying I'm perfect. I didn't have my flaws. Some people probably know it here in this room, you know. Whatever, I'm better today. And on this day, I still get stereotyped and followed and all kind of things. I don't care if I'm at the Gulch beaches or just out taking a walk. You know, I live right across the street from Gun Park, and I see them putting their lights out in the park. And, you know, I don't know if they fishing for some or I don't know, but I think it's just a bit extra. Like, if a man wants to walk his dog because it's cool out and it's dark, let that man walk his dog. Don't try to give him no ticket or be extra. And, I don't know. I don't want to start getting into this stuff too deep. I'm going to just let it go right there.
Thanks, Talis. We'll take a couple more comments. Anything else?
Hello, my name is Stephen Quinn. I'm representing HRC, and so, and maybe just as a point, I wanted to, if it's possible, just within this crowd right here, ask who would like to be on the task force, who would like to be off, and who is neutral. And I'm taking it for HRC, but I'm also taking it now so that you can maybe see what. Maybe because if it's split in half, you'll know. If it's not, you'll know. So I was just wondering, may I just right now, just in the room right now, just to show it. And neutral is also, neutral will be an option as well if you just don't want to.
Yeah, we'll add.
But once again, I'm doing this so I can take it back to HRC. So this is not necessarily for you as much as it is for me. That's why I'm asking.
Sure.
However, you will be able to see. At least from here. So I mean, if you want to partake, please help me and help HRC because we're also doing busy. But if you would like to be on the task force, would you please raise your hand?
You mean, would you like Yellow Springs?
Would you like Yellow Springs to remain on the task force? If you would, once again, it's for HRC, so this is not in any way something that will show, but it will just help us so that we can bring to Village Council exactly what people are saying. So I figure, like, what better than at a policing forum to have people show their opinion directly to the Village Council. So if you would like to remain, or if you would like Yellow Springs Police Force to remain with the task force, I already wrote down one for someone who's already said one and two, actually, so. But if there are any others, would you please like to raise your hand right now? Once again, if you would like to remain on.
But this is a group that is focused on one subject, so that is not surveying the average citizen.
Well, this isn't
true. But
this is
we'll just all.
Then don't do it. You better not do this. That's why I asked. If not, you don't need to.
I think we know. I think I can sit here and know that the majority of the people sitting out there are opposed to the task force. I don't think I need a show of hands.
HRC. That was the only purpose. Like I said, like if people really are.
Marianne is this.
I won't do it.
No,
yes, Sue. We'll hear from. Are you going to make a comment, Sue? Okay.
I'm Sue Avendrell, and there are just a few things that are not necessarily connected to each other that I've been responding to in this meeting. One is, and it's sort of a joke, I've used it before, but rules are for when brains run out. And if we have police officers who aren't thinking clearly and who are not using good judgment most of the time and who are not being respectful of citizens, we need to get rid of them. But if we have well-trained, conscientious, respectful, and ethical police, we should give them the benefit of the doubt. That's the other, that, there's another part to that, and that is, I read in the paper and I read about people complaining about the way they've been treated by the police, but then it comes to find out there's more to the story. And I would submit that if, when Chief Hale looks into some of these controversial issues, if he doesn't find that there's more to the story, that it's not just black and white, it's not just simple, good guy, bad guy, something's wrong. The police in town should be able to think more complexly than black, white, yes, no, good, bad. Because most of our interactions as people are more complex than that. And as far as the task force goes and the national drug war and that issue, I think that's a real issue. But I think in Yellow Springs, the way that issue affects all of us is that where you have a lot of drug trafficking, you also have ancillary crime. I'm not so worried about people who are, you know, adults and doing their own thing, and but I don't want my house burgled so they can get money. I don't want the kids in school to have to deal with peer pressure to use drugs that they might not want to use otherwise. I want some level of protection against that ancillary crime that always follows prostitution, pornography, drug abuse, and those kinds of social problems. That's what the task force does for us. It helps us get a better handle and I believe protect the community from outside influences that would come to town if it's a free zone and do their trafficking here. It's already happening. And it's happening in the schools. And I think that it would be 10 times worse. Sorry. I think it would be 10 times worse if we didn't have a police force that 98% of the time conscientiously tried to carry out their job. And I think they do, and I think that if we start targeting the police department and expecting them to be all things to all people, then we're going to lose those good officers, we're going to lose that good chief, we're going to be in a situation which we've been in before, where the only people willing to work here are people who are willing to abuse their power. And so I would urge people to be very careful about characterizing the police department in carte blanche negative broad brush accusations. And finally, in terms of a citizens review board, I think there's more to it than that. We have a manager, we have an assistant manager, we have a lawyer, we have a five-member council, we have a chief of police. We have people who are supervising, and they can be held accountable. But as a citizen, I don't think I want the system of safety and protection that applies to me to be decided by somebody I have no influence with. I don't want it to be decided by a citizens group whom I may not know, may not like, may not agree with. And that's what you get into when you have citizen oversight boards. There are legal issues involved, there are privacy issues involved, and I think that if you guys can't adequately supervise the policing in this town, something's wrong, because you're there, you're already in place, you have that as your job, that's what you're supposed to do, and I would expect you to do it. And I would not expect you to turn it over to a bunch of citizens, which, you know, in the days of the Wild West, that's how it was done. And you know, as well as I do, what the abuses of that can be. So I would urge you to be very careful about going in that direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. We will take one more comment. Anybody, Talis has his hands raised. Anybody that hasn't spoken tonight that would like to speak?
I won't tell you. I'm Ken O'Dorn. I'm a native, and I was around when Chief McKee was here. I know we're not going back there. I know a couple things. I just try to get this out of my head. I respect everything that's said here. I like what Chief Hale was saying about the officers' biases and the importance that he understands that it's difficult for sometimes officers to put themselves in the place of a citizen. And I also like what Chris Kinnaird said about the law and bias as it relates to these. And I think, really, this is a problem for all of us. And I think there is a problem of polarization. Some things that have been said about this community input. And I think that it would be wrong if this became a vigilante operation. I don't anticipate that council would let the power, get its own power, to get away from it in such a group. I think that, to a certain extent, the justice system has lost its credibility. We see this not just in Ferguson, but even in our town. At least I've seen it. I'm willing to give Chief Hale some time to turn things around. And I want to hold Yellow Springs and everybody here to a higher standard. And I think we can achieve that, but not overnight. It will be my purpose to establish relationships with Chief Hale and the other officers, as we used to have with Dennis Nipper, with whom I was on, you know, we were in PE together. We're not going back there. But I would ask and suggest that there is more that that Chief Hale and the force can do to get some of that back, to reestablish the trust. It's a two-way street. We got to communicate. We got to behave. We got to be respectful. And one more thing, I understand that the forces that bear on the police department and law enforcement are not always just the law or the community. Sometimes, as we see in the case of Ferguson, it's the prosecutor. It's not in our town. We don't have an independent prosecutor statute, as far as I know, or maybe we should consider it. But the forces bearing on policing, the public doesn't understand. We should all ride around in a police car and get to know them better. That said, we need to hold council and the police department to a higher standard, and I think we can achieve that. Thank you.
Thanks, Ken. Talis, I know you want to speak, so if you could make it brief.
Okay, Talis, what I want to say is one thing that I would like to see from the police officers is instead of them just being in their cruisers, like just walk up the street, I don't care if it was High, Stafford, anywhere, just walk, you know, and just engage in conversation. That would make me feel a little bit better than you riding by giving me this mug like you're ready to give me, or you just telling me hi and then, you know, that's it, that's all, and you ready to follow me when I hit left, right, straight, or whatever. You know, I could follow, I see you following me. I mean, I'm 30 years old. Another thing I want to say is, like, as far as the task force, I mean, they want you to turn on your friends. They don't care about you, period. They just want that person they're going after. That's one thing I learned when I was an informant. They wanted me to tell on my friends. They wanted me to tell on whoever. They just wanted three people. They just wanted three people. They didn't care who it was. As long as there was somebody that was in that drug trade, somebody that was out here moving serious weight or a lot of drugs. They just different people. They just want you to turn in different people. And that's all I'm going to say. I'm definitely against it because it could cause more harm than good, I believe. I mean, this is if we just talking about Yellow Springs, just a small place, and I mean, just a few officers can do this area good. I mean, if we have more cops, I believe we're going to have more crime. Now, I believe they'd be in cahoots with each other. That's just, I mean, we'd be paying more cops for what? I mean, they sit off by Dollar General, or they sit on the way toward Springfield by Young's. I mean, if you out on a late night, you see them pulling people, following people. I mean, it's just something that you don't know. Gotta be honest, I guess.
So, council, so let's bring it back to council and kind of talk about, because I'd like to wrap this part up by 9 and then take a few minutes to go over to do the commission reports. What do we see as next steps here, council? I mean, clearly this is a discussion that's going to continue.
Can I say one thing?
Sure.
What I hear, or what feels kind of like, I don't know, kind of an elephant in the room is that Yellow Springs is basically a white space. And what I mean by that is it's a space where white people are increasing, are in control. And so especially young people of color have a very different experience with the police because they're seen as outsiders. So I feel comfortable with police because I'm not, I don't look like an outsider. That's a reality. And if we don't sort of acknowledge that, then we're kind of talking past each other. And I'll never forget when I was in a psychology class early in my undergraduate career, and they flash on the screen a picture of a big black guy and a little white-haired granny, and one had knitting needles and one had a gun. And they flashed it up, let us look at it for 30 seconds, and most people thought the black guy had the gun and the knitting needles were in the granny's hands, because that's what we expect, when in reality it was the opposite. And so you can come in thinking, I am not racist, and I don't want a racist police force, and I don't want to be racist, but we have what's called implicit associations. There's a Harvard, very well documented Harvard test. Thousands and thousands of people have taken it. And most people in the country, white and black, associate good things with white people and bad things with black people. That is the reality that we live in, and it's hard if you're non-white to live in that reality. And you can't, don't have to be a bad person or a good person, white or black, to be affected by those implicit associations. And they tend to affect us when we're making split second judgments about who is good, who is bad. Is this person likely to pull out a cell phone, or are they likely to be pulling out a gun? And it's in that split second that lives are lost and bad things happen. And I think that sense that officers are so unlikely to be punished, regardless of what they do, that all levels of violence will be judged after the fact as reasonable. It feels, especially if you know that you're likely to be perceived as an outsider, it feels like they're above the law and you're always below the law and you're always under scrutiny. To me, that feels like the big issue that is hard, and it's not just about the police. It's about every single person in this room, but it's especially about people like me who are older, whiter, wealthier, who are in the dominant part of this community. And can go our whole lives feeling like everything is really just fine. I don't think it is.
And how does that fit into this, to further in this discussion? And how does that get us? And I agree with you.
It's not
instrumental,
but it's the background noise to me. But it is why I was especially concerned about training, because I would love to see the implicit association test and training regarding the implicit association be a part of police training. Because, and I don't know anywhere where it is, or I don't know if it is, but it really needs to be, because it's dangerous.
So, agreeing with what Lori said, we still have to set a path forward, how we're going to move forward.
Yeah, I mean, I think that like Brian and I could come up with a draft of the vision statement, and I think we could also list particular topics that need to be discussed, like the ACE task force. I also agree with what Lori said, and I think that's what Cheryl was talking about, that it is the water in which we swim, sort of. Well, and some of us see it and some of us don't. And how do we deal with that? I don't have an answer to that. But it is something. So in fact, I think the only way we're going to get an answer to that is to be acknowledge it and to be open to engaging with the community.
Just to kind of reiterate on the ACE task force, I do want to emphasize that that is not a discussion that's just buried in our budget discussions, but that will be a prominent discussion that, you know, we will really dig into. And again, we've talked about it being in the context of budget because it does have a cost implication for the village, but that doesn't mean that it's not its separate own important discussion. And that, I think once we establish this vision statement, is where I think we would go next. And I agree with Mary Ann, some of the other issues, the way I've characterized it, how do we best utilize Mayor's Court, I think is an important discussion that will also be one of its own, and it also has budget implications. Clearly the chief has responded to some of these other things, and I think that has to be part of, as many people have mentioned on sort of both sides of the issues, or all sides of the issues, it is council's responsibility, and I agree to give that direction to our village manager, to chief, so that they can, you know, serve the community, like that mission statement says.
So can we say that, I mean, I'm feeling like this is going to be probably an agenda item at potentially every meeting into the future. So, I mean, and maybe what we do, and if you could come back, it would be the 24th meeting, August 24th, mm-hmm. with the vision statement and you know, maybe a roadmap on next steps and how we go about, you know, it's possible that some of the issues that Lori brought up with just the inherent racism, that could go to the HRC. I mean, maybe there are some things that HRC could tackle on that, but, you know, a path forward, because these are a lot of complex issues and important issues and that need to be vetted, and I, you know, so I think, you know, maybe we will start to take things individually. Chief, any last thoughts on how you see?
Actually, before you two leave, just real fast, because you had mentioned you felt uncomfortable. One of the policies that I put out is a complaint process, how to file a complaint. I've heard a couple people mention things. It's, you know, I am not there with them all the time. They are not all the time supervised. So if you feel there is a complaint, you can call me. You can call me anonymously. You can email me. You know, it is something I will review. And if the officers are wrong, then we will document what is wrong and how to go forward with it, what discipline may be there. I have to follow legal standards. Probable cause, reasonable suspicion. And somebody got very upset one day because we went out and talked to somebody because we got a call from someone else saying this individual was doing anything. We had no idea who this individual was until we even got there. Yet we then get accused of being racist and profiling. But yet, it was a citizen who called us and alleged this individual was doing something. Those are things I have to look at in those sort of complaints. But if you have a complaint, it's one of the policies I've issued. I'd be happy to give it to somebody. Again, I'm happy to review it. It is there. But, you know, again, I can't review every second of every officer's day without those things. So feel free.
That said, also, unless we know what the officers are doing that is either wrong or perceived as wrong, we can't address it unless we know about it. So if you do have an encounter with an officer that you're uncomfortable with or that upsets you, please do call the chief and he will look at it. And if the officer is wrong or could have approached it differently, then we can address it with the officer. That's how you change people's behavior, is to constructively reinforce what they should have done, as opposed to what they did do. So please, if you have an encounter that does make you uncomfortable, please do call the chief or call me. I mean, if you don't want to talk to the chief, I mean, he's his door is always open, my door is always open, so please do that. And I see the officer beam in the back of the room.
Chief, may I? If the chief will allow, and to help with relations.
Could you introduce yourself?
I'm Jeff Beam.
Officer Jeff.
Officer Beam. Jeff, call me which one. I'd like to personally invite, the chief has also made a policy also for ride-alongs. He's let, we've had people ride along with us in the village. If it's clear with the chief, I'd like to invite anybody in this room to come ride with me some night. Come along, you ride for an hour, ride all night, I don't care. Come sit in the seat, come sit in the jump seat. If it's all right, chief.
Yeah, it is.
I threatened to do that, but it's a little different when the boss offers for the
party. Yeah. Not at all.
Officer Charles, could you introduce yourself?
Yes.
Oh, I'm Mark Charles. These are my guys who normally run the evening to be 5 till 3 in the morning shift. Sergeant Map is not here today. So.
And of course, if you have concerns about the police, we're your elected citizens. We are effectively a citizens review board. We can, we can help talk to you. I'd be happy to hear it from you, or if you feel like you want to report to places, or not a report, just have a conversation. I'm really eager to hear about it.
But again, that kind of reinforcement is how you change people's behavior over time, and it does take time. It does take a long time to change someone's behavior. If we keep plugging away at it, we'll eventually get it done.
Or I may be able to explain to you why something happened.
Exactly.
I mean, it maybe there's parts of things that you have not seen. Again, maybe we get a call and says, hey, this person's doing this. And maybe not. I don't know your situation. But I can't know your situation unless it gets drawn to my attention. So again, you can call me, call the village manager, call a council member. It will get documented. It will get looked at. And if the officer is wrong, there will be some form of discipline. And that is in policy. Okay?
Okay, thank you all for joining us. And there will be more to come. I would say there will be more in regular meetings.
Yeah, feel free to write us also.
And I expect that there will be maybe more work sessions related to this also. So next we have manager and sister manager report.
My report is in your packet, unless anyone has any questions.
John? Okay. Standing reports, Lori?
We had on the Green County Regional Board, Green County. We looked at a whole bunch of proposals on development, most of which I thought were terrible, but legally we have to love them. I'll be honest.
They were all township
developments.
I know. It's horrible.
Probably mostly Beaver Creek Township, too. And then the Planning Commission, we did not meet this past month.
Jerry?
Okay. Excuse me. I have not heard anything about community resources. I have not heard from them. Mediation, they're having a meeting six of on the the Library Commission, and then some areas that they want to mess with their band in terms of the outside of the guardrail, which is receiving nicely.
I think that was it, I think. Yeah,
finance.
We just approved the report.
I want to let you know something about the library. I'm on the Greene County Library Board, and at the first meeting I went to a local gentleman presented and brought some students from the STEM school, presented that one of their projects, their PBL project, is to erect a Virginia Hamilton state historical marker in Yellow Springs, and they had been working with Arnold Adolph, and Arnold, they just decided, well, let's just put it over on our property, somewhere on the Hamilton property, and that didn't seem right to me. It seemed like it needed to be in a more prominent spot, so we met today with Carl Cologne and Arnold. John and Scott went along, and also Kevin Light, who's the teacher, and we decided, we found a spot over at the library, basically in the front of the building, in the square bed. Now, I just want to give you, it's a preliminary discussion. It will have to come back to council for more discussion. But Connie looked at it. It's everybody seems to think that that's a good place for it. So when more details are put together, we'll come back. There will be more information provided. So the Greene County Library is paying for the marker. So it's going to be I think it'll be a nice project.
Okay, is it me?
Brian, yes.
All right, so we already talked about the, I sat on the Energy Board, at the Energy Board on behalf of Marianne. We already talked about the support for the letter of interest for realigning our energy portfolio. And I also shared with Council the letter of support that the Energy Board wrote for the Community Solutions grant about the dashboard project. And I just wanted to emphasize there, one of the things that's really important about that project is the educational potential, not only for citizens, but also for our students related to project-based learning. Community Access Panel, quite busy. One of the things I wanted to give a heads up about is Laytronics, which is our sort of technology that we use at the station, has a platform called Vibit, and we're gonna learn more about it, but we could create our own online station. It's would be substantially less than $5,000 a year. We're going to see a demo and talk more about that later, see if that's a good option for the future. We've been talking a lot about the need for a social media policy for the village. Community Access Panel is going to take that on, and hopefully we'll have a draft to look at or some recommendations in August. And in both my commissions, we're doing sort of a deep dive on the drafts for the commission ordinance and looking at, you know, should names change, should missions make more sense, and that kind of thing. And so I just wanted to sort of encourage, I guess, all council members that have commissions where that's relevant to think about that. Basically what I've been doing with each commission is giving them sort of a draft so that we can wrap that project up too. I'd like to do it August 24th, but we'll see. Public Art Commission, I want to mention we're taking nominations for the Fall VITA, the Village Inspiration and Design Award, and the deadline for those is the end of September. We're finally revising the public art policy to make it clearer and more user-friendly, and we'll have a draft of that soon with some recommendations. And an interesting thing that came up is with Jamie Sharp on the commission, looking at consistency in our village identity. I don't know if we need to talk about it a lot tonight, but part of the reason I also printed this out is, you know, just thinking about things like using the village logo and some of those things that will make all the commissions more consistent and professional with their agendas, minutes, and so forth. That's it.
Okay, Marianne.
Did you want to say something about the letter of support?
Well, I did mention that it was approved and it's already been submitted. I don't know.
So the Energy Board, I was out of town. Brian reported on that. I have not done anything with the school board liaison. The Environmental Commission. The Environmental Commission tends to meet like the day after council. So our last meeting was
a month ago,
and we're meeting tomorrow. But we talked about what would be involved in climate action planning, and I have not heard back from Deward about he was going to contact some towns in Ohio that have joined the ICLEI
because that was something that he had suggested. Talked about how to develop a baseline of where we are right now in terms of our CO2 emission, and he felt that that would be doable. We talked about different ways to do that. We talked about the glass farm and how to move the wetlands issue forward, and have some plans on doing that. Again, we also talked about having a baseline that we don't have there, which is way too late, for what was the flora and fauna, say, 2 years, well, 1 year ago. We're going to be adding some new people to the Environmental Commission, and so we're looking at that. We have some couple people that I think are interested and have good qualifications. Nadia Malarkey is working on getting a speaker to come to Yellow Springs who will work both with the village staff and with the community on how to how to avoid using toxic pesticides and herbicides. And she has a really cool program that she's going to be doing in the community with regenerative gardens.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was basically it. And then we have for our meeting tomorrow, Krista McGaw and Michelle Burns are coming, and we're going to be talking about green space funding and how we work with the council.
Anything on HRC?
And HRC had, we had a relatively short meeting. Several of the people were out of town or ill. We did give a grant to the Yellow Springs Kids Playhouse for having a play in which families of autistic children could come, and there would be things there, especially for the autistic children, because frequently autistic children don't come out into events like that because of the nature of their disability, and the families don't either. So the HRC did give a grant.
The chamber.
Oh, sorry, oh. That's the performance on the 24th, I believe.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
The chamber. We're looking at starting to do some strategic planning. The last time the chamber did a strategic plan was almost 10 years ago, and we're thinking it's time to freshen that up again. Although when we looked back at the plan we did, it still. I think still hit all the important points. And then our next member meeting is August 20th. It'll be at noon in this room, and it's going to be about the new credit card processing, the new chip that's going to go into credit cards and what that means for merchants. So we're hoping that anybody that does business with credit cards will attend that meeting, and we're going to provide pizza so you have lunch too. And then the NVRPC did not meet in July. So I think we're ready to adjourn this session. Our next meeting will be another work session. Our August 3rd meeting has been canceled. We're taking a little summer vacation break. Our next meeting will be August 17th. It's a work session. We're talking about the possibility of work sessions being conducted in this room, so we haven't decided that yet. So it will either be here in council chambers, we'll be sure to let people know. And then we will have another regular council meeting on August 24th, where we will be hearing some legislation and talking about budget issues and talking about the levy and general finance issues with the village. And Rick Perales, our state rep, Rick Perales, will also be here to have us yell at him because they keep taking money away from us. So he doesn't know that.
Oh, he does.
Well, he does that. I know he watches Channel 5. So,
I have a question, concern. When we have the work sessions, it's important, I think, that we always have someone be accountable for following up. So, and have some process for that. So in this work session, we're going to do that. But like I was thinking about, we spent a lot of time, and you did a lot of work on sidewalk.
Right.
So who,
I mean, that's
in
staff's hands, I feel.
Yeah, well, and John did do some follow-up work on that, and we were discussing a way to potentially get that done prior to
and
departure.
So. Right.
Make sure he's back.
And I mean, that's one of the things that Scott's doing. I mean, there is an ongoing assessment of the sidewalks happening. And then I think one of the things that we will be talking about potentially in this financial discussion is how we pay for it. I mean, that's part of it is a financial piece,
correct,
too.
Yeah.
We're developing a sidewalk inventory right now. Every day Scott's going out and walking a section of town, taking note of the condition of sidewalks. That will go into developing a sidewalk report. So we'll have a clearer understanding of the condition of the village's sidewalks instead of just estimating or guesstimating how much money it will cost to repair everything. You know, we'll be able to be more strategic in the way that we approach the sidewalks.
Right, okay.
I would like to hear eventually from the people who are here about this venue and whether this works very well, because one problem is we don't have microphones, and I have to keep reminding myself to use my teacher voice, but I'm used to having a microphone, so I'm not always been perfect. So if this hasn't worked, I think whilst we're making that decision, it'd be helpful.
Emails,
to
Susan, do you
emails
have an opinion?
Would be great.
I'll be able to tell more afterwards.
But let us know that, if you could, pretty quickly.
Yeah, or send an email to Patty or us or anybody, and so we have a sense for whether it worked or not.
Are you asking people sitting
so,
in the chair?
In terms of the work sessions, I don't know, maybe you've already decided it, but is there a format that you would be using? Is there a regular way for people to participate? Or What's the protocol that you're going to use for the work session so that we can kind of know what to expect?
Well, the work session in most communities as it's been conceived and part of the model that we're using is that a lot of it is hearing from staff and it's discussion among council and staff, and that's actually what we've done with a couple of work sessions we've had so far. We heard from John about sidewalks. I think that there was another one about energy.
There was,
we're talking about charter.
Right.
There was a charter one, I believe. Didn't we do an environmental commission? Or was that just a presentation?
You know, this one was specifically about policing. We probably didn't hear from Chief as much as we would normally in a work session, but I think part of that was because we were talking among ourselves, something which we really hadn't done before. I think it's a little fluid. I mean, I would see a little bit of what happened tonight being very much of how it might go depending upon the topic. We're still working on it. We're still working through it. It's become a little complex because of the fact that it seems that at every meeting there's some piece of legislation. So we can't decide on legislation. We can't make any decisions at work sessions. So it's become a little complicated. So far, I think it's worked, though. I feel as if it's opened up, at least for us, a little bit more comfortable discussion. I don't know if we figured out how to work the audience into it yet. I'm not sure that this setup works either. Maybe we just need to think about it more. You know, people feel that council chambers doesn't work because, you know, we're sitting up higher, but I feel like we're a little bit actually closer to everybody there than we are here. So I think that, I don't think we're ready to move them in here yet. I think we'll probably do the next one in council chambers.
Well, I will say, I thought this worked really well for this discussion, so.
I too thought it worked well, and I don't know whose idea it was to have the raise so high. But that seems to be sort of unnecessarily imposing, and the town is small, but never mind, I can live with it. Somebody designed it in that way, but I like this, for this sort of situation, I like this kind of
right, well in that case it was also mayor's courts in there and,
right.
and legally required,
of course,
so, yeah.
And part of the issue was, because that became an issue for staff to have to take furniture in and out of the
right.
Of the room,
yeah.
so we were trying to make one unit.
Yeah, it's okay. But it's good to have this space for such a circumstance.
And maybe it's the table. Maybe we can work out the details. You know, we're also talking about having better video capabilities than we have here for presentations. So, you know, we're really trying to make this work and to make it work for all of us and for the community.
Thank you. That's clear.
So you will be doing an agenda.
We do an agenda.
And we did do an agenda for this session.
I saw that. And you will be making time for citizen input?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, as I said, that's not the way they typically are in other communities. You know, what we're doing, and we've actually added a few other things to the work session agenda, like standing reports. Since standing reports really aren't about decision making, we decided to put that in the work session. And we're also including petitions and communications we receive, because we don't want a month to have to go. If somebody sent us a letter or communication, we don't want a month to have to go past before we acknowledge it. And we'll hear from our manager and assistant manager at both forums too. So we're trying to keep them as separate in intent as possible, but make sure people aren't losing things in the time frame between the regular meetings. So, I mean, continue to give us input, because that's how we're going to figure out if this is working, how it's working.
Yeah.
So, thank you all for being here.
I want to get back to how we make sure that something's being carried along. I would like to have staff do something, but if there's some kind of, and it could be on a website, I don't know, but we talk about sidewalks, then it would be just good to know what is being done, and
or John could,
if it's any of the things that we spend this amount of time on.
Right, well, he had it in a staff report, what he's, I think.
No, he didn't.
Well, because...
Well, the answer...
Yeah. I guess I'm sort of thinking almost like an Excel spreadsheet that has sidewalk, work session, next step.
Well,
and then all of the things that we have work sessions on, so we could look at, oh, this is where sidewalks
so
is.
You,
is where
so what you would really like is a calendar that projects maybe out where we're going to have the next work session on sidewalks.
Well, not necessarily
just the next
work session.
Like a
what
work
the next, I mean, if John is going to, in the sidewalks thing, or Scott, or whoever is doing something, so just so that we can be looking at these things, we're dealing with all these things, and I don't want to just throw it out the window.
We can do it like a construction schedule, which you know what a construction schedule.
So we're only going to pick out the things that we're doing in
I think because
work sessions, is that what you're suggesting?
Maybe it isn't just work sessions.
Well,
it's maybe mostly with work sessions, because we can't make any decisions at work sessions. So
and they're big, typically, right?
Well,
we can
do a, if you'll recall the project timeline I did for everyone last fall, where I had each,
yes.
all of the projects we had going,
yes.
and when they were going to finish it. We can do something like that.
Thinking something like that.
Something, because, I mean, one of the things that John and I kind of kicked around after the regular meeting was, perhaps we should consider putting off the economic development discussion so that we can finish sidewalks before John leaves.
Okay.
That's just a thought. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of having the 20th or the 17th be
well,
the,
and then finishing
we lose John's input at the same time.
You do.
So
I would
be concerned about doing that.
Well, he's in the middle of the sidewalks, though.
Right.
So.
And the thing about that then is that would follow then the discussion about financing potentially could follow on the heels of that at the following
meeting.
Correct.
Just the thought that we may want to dispose of the sidewalk issue before John leaves.
I don't agree. So I want John's input on it because he's been thinking about it the whole time. And
you mean on economic development?
Yes, and I think we've. You know, we made progress on sidewalks. You know, I think John can leave us with a plan and we can pick that up.
Right, and I mean, really, that does become a policy decision.
Right.
I think so far it's been so big because we are talking about these big numbers. We're not looking at the reality of the sidewalk assessment. We have that to look at, then we can start to talk in more realistic terms. And if he can start to attach, you know, attach schedules, dollar amounts, that kind of thing to it, prioritize, then it really comes back to us to talk about the policy of who's going to pay for it. And then when we set the policy of who's going to pay for it, then we have to find if it stays with council, if it stays with the village, then we have to figure out where that money's going to come from. So I hear what you're saying. And maybe it's because I'm in agenda planning and so I know what's being discussed. I felt like that one and knowing what John's doing with the sidewalk assessment, I feel comfortable that that is moving forward.
We'll work on one of those plans, timesheet things like I had last year. So.
Great.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right, I'm going to go get the recycle bag out.